bullshit.
Impact was not the worst show I've ever seen. I start this every week. Can we just play this on a loop? So it's not the worst show I've ever seen.
I would say this is above average by Impact standards.
Which means a below average television show.
Of course.
Let's talk about it. I actually did love the opening segment. It opened with Abyss coming out and cutting a promo. And this, of course, last week, Mick Foley beat him up. And that was the last thing we saw when we went off the air. And so the first thing we saw when we came on the air this week was this. Good. So he came out and said doctors wouldn't let him compete, but he needed some answers. And the crowd chanted, "We want answers." Will not be the last time they chant this in the next several months. So Foley came out with his barbed wire bat, flanked by security. And he basically said Abyss had stolen everything from him. And somehow he still thought that Mick owed him something. He said he didn't owe him shit. He said Abyss said all he was trying to do was save Foley last week, and the picture thing was an accident. He said he went into Foley's office to help save him, accidentally knocked the picture off the wall, and that was my fault, he said. Stop. The reason Foley knew that Abyss was the perpetrator was because the Motor City Machine Gun said, "You know there's a security camera in your office." So Mick went and looked at the tape and learned it was Abyss. How did he look at the tape, determine it was Abyss, yet not know that it was an accident? That makes no sense.
Right.
All right. Just making sure. Just making sure that Vince Russo wrote something and didn't think it out. So Foley asked if he'd given permission to Abyss to go to his office and said he never needed Abyss's help. "I don't need you. I don't need your help." Abyss said Foley was a hero, the operative word being was. Said he idolized him, wanted to be like him, got into the business because of him, got through all the beatings he received as a child because of him, and this was how he was repaid? And he showed his 24 stitches, and then Foley was like, "Well, I got my hand hurt last week with a videotape being smashed into a head." And he said he had something for Abyss. It was a copy of the Foley Borash picture. But he said, "It's not the real deal. It's just a cheap ripoff, just like you." And then he hit him with the picture, at which point the fans in the Impact Zone chanted, and I quote, "You sold out." What does that mean?
It's like they have a random chant generator.
So Abyss went to chase him backstage. All of the geeks tried to stop him. Abyss killed him one at a time and gave the last one a choke slam on the ramp.
Bad times.
And then he ran with his arms like this backstage.
Bryan's waving his arms in the air.
That was the end of the segment.
Yes.
I actually did really like this, except for the giant faux pas.
There was one giant, well, the performances of both men, great. The intensity of the promo, great. I cannot get over the fact that the whole thing is about a stupid cartoon picture of Mick Foley and Jeremy Borash.
Yeah. And you know the
and
explanation.
It does not make Mick Foley scary and crazy because he's getting so violent over this picture.
No,
it makes him stupid.
That's the idea, though. That's their excuse, that Mick Foley is so unstable that he can flip out over something as stupid as a picture. Okay? To me, that's called a cheap way to get out of being a good writer. You're coming up with some sort of explanation for something that makes no sense, and it's a cheap shortcut. Oh, well, it makes sense for Foley to do this because his character is a guy who would freak out over somebody breaking his picture. Okay? Bullshit. Then we had, what did we have? Abyss was going nutty after commercial, yeah. And Lauren was trying to calm him down, and then she screamed, "Someone cover the interviews. I can't leave him like this." Has there ever been a more unprofessional character in the history of wrestling?
I suppose if we analyzed Impact, we'd find many.
And by the way, she didn't appear at all, I don't think, for the rest of the show.
No,
so she was not helping him.
No.
She was not doing her job. She just vanished.
Because we saw plenty of Abyss.
Anyway, that was something else. Then we got Idiocy. Kiyoshi, Red, Bashir, Consequences Creed, and Jay Lethal in a five-way ladder match where the winner gets an X title shot in a normal match next week. Yeah.
A random five-way ladder match for a title shot.
3 minutes and 57 seconds.
Yes.
With a cutaway in the middle of the match for Foley going nuts, or Abyss going nuts, yeah, or somebody.
And at first it was just a split screen, and I could deal with that, because there was a wrestling match in one corner, and then Abyss in the lower. And then they just put Abyss on screen. And there was a number one contender's match going on in the background with a ladder, and we didn't see any of it. That was annoying.
Then when Red won, Borash interviewed him, and he asked him about the match next week. And Red is like, well, I'm not thinking about next week's match. I'm just enjoying my win.
Yes.
Cue Brock Lesnar. That was a stupid answer.
This was the first, I believe, the first Red promo I ever saw, and now I know why. He has nothing good
Actually,
to say.
Actually, I expected significantly worse.
Sure. But at least from the match of what we saw, and again, we actually saw maybe 2 minutes of this, but usually these five ways, everyone hits a bunch of moves, and then one guy who happens to be standing around in the end wins. This one, the story was, Amazing Red kicked everyone's ass and won the got the contract. He beat up one guy, then another, then made consequences create apparently vomit on live TV.
Yes.
I shouldn't say live. On TV, they showed multiple replays of this apparent vomiting.
He gave him a DDT, and Creed just vomited. It's like, what?
He beat the puke out of him.
I guess so.
And this warranted replays. And so after laying all his opponents flat, Red climbed the ladder and got the contract. It was like, okay, something was accomplished here.
Yes.
Red beat up everyone. I understand that. For that reason alone, a thumbs up.
They cut backstage again to Abyss running wild.
One more thumbs down.
And then immediately cut away.
Yeah, well, that too. But at that promo, they had Jeremy Borash interviewing Amazing Red. And I know he's the X Division guy. He's supposed to be the small underdog. Jeremy Borash towered over him.
Yeah.
I cannot believe how short Amazing Red was.
He's a small man.
Jesus.
Well, Borash may have been up the ramp a bit, which would have been even funnier.
Would be even dumber.
Yeah.
He should have been standing down the ramp. In fact, Red should have been on the ramp. Borash should have been on the floor.
Yeah.
But no, they're dumb.
So Borash interviewed Stevie about his match with Kevin Nash. Stevie yelled a lot. Said, the deal was you got $50,000 if you ended a business career. Nash didn't do that. Therefore, he was a liar and a thief. He said Nash may have his money, but he was going to end Nash's career tonight. And anyway, he didn't. Nash not only beat him, but he powerbombed him. Very shitty powerbomb, by the way. And then put a foot on Stevie's chest for the pin. It sucks to be Stevie.
Oh, what can you do? Taz got in a big Stevie
retire?
Cool. You could retire. Go back to medicine full time, I guess. Taz got in a big Stevie cool reference, which is 12 years old, but it made me laugh, so I don't mind. And, you know, as Kevin Nash matches go, he laid there and sold literally the entire time, then hit one boot and one powerbomb and won. So it's about all you can hope for.
Then we had Eric Young looking for Angle with his crew, and they stormed into the dressing room. And he basically demanded an apology for Angle's actions last week. A replay would have been nice. We didn't get one. Instead, we got Eric Young repeatedly saying, look it.
Yes.
Look it.
That is his catchphrase.
Look it. So everyone started yelling at each other, and Eric finally said, I have a match with Morgan tonight. I will show you, Kurt, how you should have dealt with this man at the beginning, and then off they stormed. We'll get into this a little more later.
It took you 20 seconds to say that. It seemed like an hour on TV.
Tracy and Christy Hemme in a Playboy bunny match. I want to play something here before we get into this.
My love, there's only you in my life.
I've gotten a little girl outfit because I like dressing up like a little girl.
I count that as great news.
The only thing that's right.
My first love.
Why is this so goddamn long? I just want the drops.
Every breath that I take.
All right, that was a fail.
Sorry, Brian.
Just give us the drops, everybody. Anyway, this was a match with Tracy and Christy. And Tracy came out to the main event Mafia music. Anyone remember that angle? She's in the Mafia, everybody.
There was I think it was last week, it was the show where they started with the Mafia in the ring. And I saw a woman standing there, and I thought, Survivor Jenna, no, she's gone! Oh, wait, that's Tracy.
Yeah. Christy missed her leg drop off the middle rope. This was not the finish.
No.
Then
and then, best of all,
She'd get a cradle out of the corner for the pin.
She won anyway.
So for those keeping track, WWE playmates are greater than TNA playmates. And then afterwards, Tracy beat her up anyway because she had to get her heat back. Why didn't they just have her win?
Understand any of this.
Why didn't they just have Tracy win? I don't know.
I don't have a clue.
Backstage, Foley was beating up Abyss, and then Abyss made a comeback, and Geeks broke it up. Again, Lauren nowhere to be seen.
Yes, so yeah.
This was actually a comical beating.
It was, because...
I think their match is going to be really fun. Because they're both so goofy, and they're going to do dumb shit.
Oh, they're undoubtedly going to do stupid shit. But yeah, so Abyss, in a furious rage now at this point for about an hour, had finally found Foley, and they got his ass kicked. That's comedy number one. Comedy two, Lauren was nowhere to be seen. Comedy three, the security geeks ran up, and apparently they wanted this to sound like a massive crowd, even though they had about five guys. So the security guys came up, all of them just going, hey, 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 over and over again. Like a pack of dogs barking furiously.
Yeah.
Made me laugh.
Then we had an interview with AJ and Sting, hosted by TNA. Now, for literally no reason, the graphic for AJ and Sting at Bound for Glory now says, Sting's final curtain call? So I thought, okay,
I didn't
well,
even notice.
I guess they're building up perhaps a retirement stip or something like that, so I sure hope they talk about that during this interview. No. AJ wanted to know if Sting passed the torch or if he just didn't want to be champion anymore. He said they're two completely different things. And I thought, no, they're exactly the same. They are the exact same thing, actually.
I don't know.
So he wanted to know if Sting would be ready at Bound for Glory. And he said, if you don't, maybe you shouldn't even lace him up if you don't know.
Then he said he loved him.
And then he walked away.
He mumbled a lot, and he walked off.
Sting just stared at him. And then, AJ left.
This is bullshit.
It failed.
Whatever they were trying to do, it was a miserable, miserable failure. AJ came off looking like a nervous geek, and he's a champion.
Yeah.
That's poor. This is dumb.
Sting's final curtain call?
I don't know.
They made no mention of this at all, and it's in the graphic.
About 15 minutes ago, I called this an above-average impact. Looking back, I was wrong.
Yes.
This is a bad show.
Well, the end of it made you think that. We'll get into that in a minute.
I guess.
Tara came out to do commentary for ODB and Awesome Kong for the women's title. Did Awesome Kong win a match, by the way, last week? I've already forgotten.
Do not think.
There was no replay.
Do not think.
All right, so anyway. They had this match, ODB and Awesome Kong, with the women's title on the line. Tara, meanwhile, doing commentary, is plugging her auto detail shop.
Right.
Kim Couture.
Uh-huh.
It's just on and on.
Does she still own that pizza place? Because she did not plug that.
No, she sold that.
Ah, that's why she didn't plug it.
So, in the middle of the match, Raisha went over and shoved her. They went face-to-face. Kong cut Tara off for the pass. Tara snapped her neck on the top rope. ODB cradled Awesome Kong for the pin. It was a horrible cradle. Kong is now just another wrestler. Why ODB had to beat Kong here on this TV show, I have no earthly idea. But you always knew that in the end, Kong would be just another girl on the show, and they have achieved that.
Yes, and you're not even getting to the best part of this, which was the afterwards.
Oh, yeah, Kong got her heat back.
Well, not even that. Let's review. Tara was doing commentary, and when she was not plugging her other outside of wrestling interests, she was just generally horrible. So she starts stalking Raisha. Kong grabs her by the hair. Tara necks Kong on the ropes. ODB rolls up Kong and pins her. Tara helped ODB win, right?
Mm-hmm.
So then ODB and Tara get in the ring, and they begin to trade blows.
Yes.
They're brawling.
Yeah.
Why?
Well,
why would either of them be angry about what has happened?
I don't know.
So then they're brawling, and then it got best of all when Kong came back in and laid them both out.
Yeah.
Everyone got buried in the segment.
Yeah. Not a single person got over here. What a fabulous segment.
The show blew.
Then we had Angle and Hernandez. Hernandez did his long-delayed suplex, and then Angle did a German, cut him off, and worked his leg for like 2 minutes, and then Hernandez made a comeback and didn't sell the leg at all. They were brawling outside. And then here on the show where people brawl outside all the fucking time, they got counted out of the ring. So then the evil foreigners ran out, and they grabbed Angle, and they dragged him backstage, and the Mafia showed up to save the day. Again, we'll talk more about this a little later.
This match was fun while it lasted, for 120 seconds or so.
Shelley and Sabin did an interview. saying Mick Foley was right. Their entrance music was, in fact, shitty. Said next week they'd have a brand new theme and an accompanying music video to debut. That I'm actually excited about.
You've never seen two men so happy to get a new song.
Well, what else are they doing on this show?
Nothing. But, and then Sabin took time to bury his old Hail Sabin song, which my first thought was, hey, that was kind of cool. Then I remembered, wait, no.
You're a geek.
The chanting of Hail Sabin was okay. The music behind it did suck.
Then we had Velvet and Madison come into the ring to look sad. Didn't even do their entrance, and Mike Tenay, in a disappointed manner, said, and this has to become a drop, no butt close-up. It's his exact words. So Velvet said that we all knew by now that due to contractual issues, Angelina Love was no longer part of the Beautiful People. Said it was time to come clean. She said over the past year, her and Madison had not been proud of their actions, especially during the time, I guess, when Madison and the Beautiful People were actually feuding with each other. Anyway, said that Angela was nasty, rude, disrespectful, inconsiderate, and that's why they were so mean. And she said Angelina turned them into monsters, made them do things they didn't want to do. And anyway, they wanted the tag champs, Taylor and Sarita, to come out so they could apologize to them face-to-face. This was fucking classic. Taylor and Sarita come out. They have this look on their face like they don't believe a goddamn word these girls are saying. They're even mouthing, I don't buy this. So the heels extend their hands, and the baby faces shake.
And then?
And they're immediately jumped.
Yes.
Like the dumbest dumb shits ever.
Well, you can't see that because Hernandez is on the show.
That's true. That's true.
He's still dumber.
So they were
beating on
him.
The dumbest women on the show.
And the babyface were starting to do a comeback. And then who should hit the ring but Lacey Von Erich, who laid out all the babyfaces with the most horrendous offense imaginable, and then put the fucking iron claw, the iron claw on Sarita. I am not making this up.
I'm fine with that. That was her only move that looked good.
Work-wise, she looked at the level of Rocka Khan.
She is definitely easily the worst Von Erich of all time. I include Lance, Mike, and Chris in that statement. And, yeah, that's why I'm fine with the claw. She cannot screw up the claw.
Well,
she should do nothing else.
She could not hold on tight enough and let go or something.
That's probably coming.
And, by the way, they did an interview later, and basically just did the Beautiful People interview, and she actually said, Lacey Von Erich actually said, or no, maybe Velvet said.
Velvet said this about Lacey.
Yeah, she said, she is the heir apparent to the Von Erich throne.
Hmm.
This is good news?
As family dynasties go.
This is a positive?
You could do better.
The heir apparent to the Von Erich throne. My God. Matt Morgan did an interview saying he didn't give a fuck about Angle versus Eric Young, and tonight he was going to hurt Eric and kill Angle at the pay-per-view. This is fine. Then we had the match.
I can't even see Eric Young anymore without just seeing red with anger.
So Matt destroyed him early. Eric cut him off, got the heat for, I swear to God, 10 seconds. Morgan ran wild, went outside and started clapping hands with fans at ringside, and suddenly a man in a Mankind mask jumped the rail and waffled him with a chair. It was Kurt Angle. Now, by the way, throughout the show, you could see this Mankind guy in the crowd, even when Kurt was also backstage doing other segments. How this worked, I have no idea. Magic. But anyway, it was a DQ. Yes, a DQ on this show.
He was also there when Kurt Angle was in the ring wrestling. So there's a grand switcheroo done at some point.
So then World Elite and the Mafia came out, and there was a big brawl. And I ask you all, Crumbly, you're included, who could possibly care about World Elite against the Main Event Mafia? I mean, again, send your emails.
Yes.
Feel free to send me emails. If you could possibly care in the slightest about the Main Event Mafia against the World Elite for any reason other than, like, Kevin Nash against Kiyoshi, please tell me why. Then we had Team 3D and Lashley doing a promo about how they were facing Rhino and the British Invasion. I was thinking, at the pay-per-view? Tonight?
No.
Apparently it was tonight.
In 2 minutes.
Yeah. And Bubba actually did a great promo about wanting to kill the invasion. And then Devon was in the middle of doing his catchphrase, and Bobby cut him off with the testify line, and Devon erupted into an enormous cackling belly laugh.
Yes.
That this man, you never saw a man so happy that someone had stolen his material.
No.
It was fabulous.
It was great. This, yeah, the usual great Team 3D promo, even though Bubba apparently had a sore throat. But it was so great that Bubba could get away with lines that no one would ever actually say, such as, Rhino, you had no reason to gore me. Which, out of context, sounds ridiculous. But when Bubba Ray Dudley screams in a promo, it sounds okay.
I got to say, I love Team 3D of late. I don't think they're ever getting in the Hall of Fame, the Observer Hall of Fame, but they do cut really good promos, and they have pretty damn good matches all the time. Nothing spectacular or anything like that, but I do enjoy them as a team. I got no problem with them. So Beer Money came out to do commentary for the main event. It was Rhino, British Invasion against Team 3D and Lashley, and they had a match. They cut off Devon by pulling him crotch first into the post.
At which point James Tord noted, and I quote, that hurts your balls.
Yeah. So Beer Money and Taz were cackling about how fat Bubba was. Lashley got the hot tag, ran wild, six-way. And they babyfaces hit a diving headbutt to the yam bag of Rhino. And then Lashley tapped out Williams with the dragon sleeper. And the show ended. It was a fun main event, and then the show ended.
Yeah, the good guys had a giant celebration.
This is why you didn't think the show was so bad.
Team 3D went over to Beer Money. They all shared a beer while Lashley walked around ringside slapping hands, and then the show stopped. And I was caught off guard because no one attacked them or anything. No.
I learned this lesson at least 10 years ago when WWE would have these god-awful undercards. I mean, the shittiest undercards you can imagine. And then they have an awesome main event. And the pay-per-view is over, and you go, man, I feel like I got my money's worth. And then WCW would run these shows with these awesome undercards, and then they'd put Roddy Piper and Hulk Hogan in a rickety cage in the worst match imaginable, and you'd think, this is the shittiest company in the world. What a horrible pay-per-view. Because the last thing you see is what you remember. And this show ended with a good main event. The show just went off the air afterwards, and so when it was over, you thought, that Impact was not half bad.
And one more note about the main event, it also, I don't know if established is the right word, but the lesson of the show was, of the match was, Bobby Lashley got the hot tag and killed everyone and then choked out Doug with a dragon sleeper. He's a dangerous, dangerous man. That's the point of this match.
Yep.
Matches that have a point are good.
To the back!
All right, we're going to do Impact here, and then I'm going to try and find an oldie but a goodie song that we haven't played for a while that everybody really loved. And it's buried in my email somewhere. I have not put it on the drop board, so I'm going to have to search for it. So, Vinny, you start talking about Impact, and I'm going to take a look.
Abyss came out for a promo, and when I was opening my Impact file to start taking notes, I saw the last week's show opened with Abyss coming out for a promo.
Actually, let me talk about this segment, because I know I loved it more than you, if that's possible.
Let me just say that Abyss versus Mick Foley, because it's opening two shows in a row, is apparently the top program in the company.
Well, I don't know. I don't know if I go that far, but I actually thought this promo was awesome. I have become a huge fan of Abyss, as most of you are well aware. I think his promos are fantastic. Basically, he came out to open up the show, and he did a promo about how Mick had wrestled all over the planet. He bled everywhere, but he had never bled like Abyss was going to make him bleed at the pay-per-view. Strangely enough, people booed. Even though Abyss is supposed to be the babyface and Foley is supposed to be the heel. Plus, why would you boo blood? Apparently these people have seen enough.
They're very squeamish.
Yeah. Maybe it was all the WWE board of directors was in the crowd.
That would explain why they were cheering for Foley as well.
So he said he was there to challenge Foley not to a match at the pay-per-view, but to the Monsters Ball. And he said at Bound for Glory, Mick was not going to have a nice day because he was going to beat his ass. Which point Foley came out and he was about to speak when Abyss cut him off and just kept ranting. He said that Foley had called him a cheap knockoff. He wanted to know if he was a cheap knockoff back in 2004 at the first lockdown pay-per-view or when he got ripped to shreds with barbed wire or when he beat Sting for the TNA heavyweight title, which, if you've been listening to this show carefully, we have confirmed actually did happen.
Via disqualification.
Well, there was that. Said while he was spilling blood, Foley was busy writing kids' books and playing with a sock puppet. Said Foley was right. There was a big difference between the two of them. And that was that he was hardcore and Foley just used to be. And he said Foley was the cheap knockoff because he was only half the man he used to be. And fans were chanting hardcore legend, presumably at Foley, who I thought was the heel. But Foley, anyway, said that as the executive shareholder, he was taking off the $50,000 bounty on Abyss's head. And by the way, explain that to me.
That's
How can you put a ban on a bounty that someone else has put on someone?
Yeah, well, I don't know, but it also implies that prior to the banning, the TNA office was endorsing this $50,000 bounty to end one of their wrestlers' careers.
Not to mention, if you're Mick Foley, and your goal is to kill Abyss, why wouldn't you want to collect the bounty while you were at it?
I don't know.
He just prevented himself from getting $50,000.
Yeah.
What a dumb shit.
This made no sense.
So this is half the Foley that he used to be, because 5 years ago, there's no way he would have turned down $50,000.
Certainly true.
So he announced that he was going to tweak the pay-per-view match. He said thumbtacks were banned, which is an odd thing to promise to people. And he said if Abyss used them, he'd lose the match. And he also said they had a special guest referee for the night. It was Dr. Stevie. I'd like to pretend that the whole thing just ended here, because it was still great at this point. But then it got shitty. And that was as Stevie came out, talked about how nobody gave a shit about Abyss. He was nothing more than an annoyance to the world. And out came Lauren. And Stevie called her a $20 a night streetwalker, which, just out of curiosity, I'm interested in knowing what street that is, just for historical purposes.
Take your quarter, find Mabel.
And Abyss to attack him, but Daphne made the save. Foley proceeded to attack him with a barbed wire bat. Matt Morgan made the save. They said Abyss was Morgan's partner later. The whole thing just fucking fell apart. And you know what? I saw a video of all the TNA knockouts doing I think it was for Esquire or something like that. They're doing a photo shoot, and all the girls were there. And, like, Lauren was by far my favorite. She's just a fantastic woman. But her presence in this angle makes me want to strangle someone, quite frankly. This whole thing fell apart as soon as they brought that bullshit in.
I
just hate it because her job is a backstage interviewer, and now she's not doing her job. She's cozying up with wrestlers. You know what I mean? It's like,
you're jealous?
Why? No. Why is she not fired?
Well, I don't
know. Why is she still employed?
Well, I don't know.
This is the least professional person I've ever seen working at a wrestling event.
Think of the ground that covers.
She's still, I don't know. Maybe I'm trying to analyze this too much, but these are the things that really annoy me, because I want my shit to make sense, and
well,
this does not.
No, none of this made sense. There's a lot of Vince Russo here. We already discussed how the executive shareholder banned a bounty. We are not sure how he has the power to do this, or if he does have the power to do this, why he waited a month, 2 months, whatever it's been, why TNA let it go on. We have already discussed how it's a Vince Russo show, so once per show, a woman must be called a prostitute or degraded in some manner. It's a Vince Russo show, so there must be a wacky stip, and the wacky stip here is a no-thumbtacks monsters ball match. So as I understand it, barbed wire, chairs, trash cans, tables, glass, but no thumbtacks. Is that the rules? Do you know?
That appears to be the rules, yes.
Yeah.
So you can use anything you want except thumbtacks.
Which may be tables are safer, but I mean, I would rather go into thumbtacks than go into glass. Maybe it's just me. So, yes.
Not to mention, Foley just did a promo for some newspaper, and he was talking about how thumbtacks really don't hurt all that bad. You just have to not get them in your eye.
Yes, he said they're safe. He didn't say they don't hurt. But I'm sure it's true. I don't recall anyone being hospitalized for thumbtacks. I think they just went through pain. The only part of this I did like was Daphne came out wearing a cute hat. It was a small top hat held onto her head with a chin strap. And after her nut shot, when she nut shot at Abyss, she then stopped to adjust said hat. That made me at least giggle.
That's very important that your little hat doesn't fall off.
It is.
All right, so that was that segment there. And no buys, just because too much bullshit going on. So then after that, we had the Borash interviewing Eric Young, and this was, again, where the show fell off the cliff. Eric Young's doing a promo, and he says, "The war's over. We have declared victory on the Mafia." And I thought, what did you achieve with this win? And I was also imagining, like, the Mafia sitting around in their locker room and hearing Eric Young declare victory over the Mafia, and all of them just looking at each other and thinking, okay, you win. Who gives a fuck? So then he said Hernandez was dead to him, dead to the World Elite, and that he was never getting a match with Eric Young in the ring. And again, I could imagine Hernandez sitting in front of a monitor and thinking, I can never wrestle Eric Young. Who gives a fuck? So then they went to Angle and they asked him. Borash is like, the World Elite just said that, you know, they won the war. And Angle inexplicably, I mean, for no good reason, flipped out. And he put a $30,000 bounty on Eric's head, which only on a Vince Russo scripted show could you have an opening segment where the leader of the company rescinds a $50,000 bounty on the head of a man that he could beat up and take the bounty. And two segments later, another guy is putting a bounty on someone else's head. It's amazing. Amazing television.
It really is astounding how it all works. The Eric Young promo, Borash, or whoever was doing the interviewing, asked him, basically said there are rumors that it will be Eric Young versus Hernandez at Bound for Glory. Then Eric said, the rumors are true. And I said, okay, so he's wrestling Hernandez. Then he said, I am not wrestling Hernandez. And I had no idea what was going on.
I still don't.
I was bewildered by this. At least the Angle promo I knew. He doesn't like Eric Young. He'll pay someone $30,000 to beat him up. Okay, this I understand.
Nash faced Hernandez, and it was pretty bad, but not worse than Regal and Tatsu. And
that is sad and true.
Eric ran in for the DQ, and Hernandez went for a power bomb, which was the shittiest finish. And then he gave Hernandez a pile driver, and then he handed Nash the belt and told him that he had saved his title. And by the way, during this match, Taz was talking to TNA, and he said, later tonight, I'm going to have a special party in my private locker room after the show. And I thought, wow, that sounds intriguing. And then he goes, we're all going to watch Global Impact 2.
A bad party.
So, and WWE and honestly, is right. It's about TNA.
In hindsight, that's actually an even shittier party than I thought at the time.
Yes.
Yeah. So they booked Hernandez, who they announced as the strongest man in TNA, and then booked him with Kevin Nash, who would not take any of his power stuff. Who could not take any of the power stuff, I should say. I don't blame Nash for this. I blame TNA. So, yeah, basically, since Hernandez couldn't do anything, Nash took the entire match. Hernandez got some brief offense, and then as soon as he even teased a powerbomb, Eric Young cut him off and then hit a pile driver. I also like there was a spot where Hernandez whipped Kevin Nash into the steel post outside. There's a flaw in this spot, and that is that Kevin Nash cannot run.
Yeah.
This looked so bad.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, a giant thumbs down here.
Abyss thanked Morgan for helping him out tonight and said he didn't want this tag match any more than Morgan did. And I was sitting there thinking, why would they not want a team together? And you reminded me that the last time we saw them, they were feuding. I had completely forgotten that.
I forget the details of it. I remember they were a team, and then Morgan turned into a bad guy.
That's right.
Lauren was probably involved.
Wasn't this one of those deals where they had been a team for like one match and then they were doing a breakup?
Something like that, yes.
I think that was the deal. So anyway, after commercial, Nash met with Eric and wanted to know what that was all about and wanted to know why he shouldn't just snap Eric's neck and get the $30,000. And Eric said, well, listen, I'm supposed to face Hernandez at the pay-per-view, which I thought he said he wasn't going to do, but he's going to. So he said, if I give you $60,000, why don't we make it a three-way? And we'll take Hernandez out for good, you'll retain your title, and you'll get $60,000. And Nash was cool with this idea. Now, Nash, of all people, should know to get payment in advance, but he didn't. So this is not the same Kevin Nash it used to be. But apparently that's the storyline there. So then we had Hernandez doing a promo. He yelled at Eric Young for approximately 8 seconds, and they immediately cut away.
Yeah.
A retarded segment.
It was very, very, very bad. There was a bit here where we started talking about Abyss and Morgan, but they basically agreed they do not like each other, but they will get along and work together to win this one tag match just for tonight. And to be honest, I was perfectly fine with this segment. They recognized these guys had history, and they had a storyline reason to get over it, which is just that we can get past this for one night.
Yeah.
It's very simple.
We had Joe versus Red for the X title. Joe beat the shit out of him forever. Lashley came out to watch. Apparently they're wrestling at Bound for Glory, although that had not been mentioned at this point, I don't think. And Joe is screaming at Earl Hebner to let Lashley in the ring.
Meanwhile, Amazing Red is lying dead in the corner.
Yeah, he's been killed. So the ref is like, oh, you want Lashley in the ring? Well, fine, go for it. So Lashley hits the ring in the middle of a wrestling match for the X title. They fight. Lashley gives him a full Nelson slam. Red then hits a spinning moonsault and a running shooting star press and gets the pin. They actually called this the biggest upset in the history of TNA. I wanted to punch the TV through the back of its head, pull its brain out, throw it on the ground, and spin on it, like Quentin Jackson.
And then kick it in the nuts.
Could you... I was on the show with Dave the other day, and spoiler for next week, everybody. We were talking about the Impact tapings, and I was like, I hear the tapings that Don West returns as a manager. And I'm like, you know, I Don West is no longer on TV. I really thought it would be cool for him to come back as a manager. That's so great. But then I realized he's the manager for Red.
Oh, no.
Red. And Dave's like, yeah, and Red beats Joe for the title at Impact. And I'm like, Joe beats Red? Or Red beats Joe? What the fuck? How the fuck do they do that? And I'm thinking of all these ways and this and that, and how does it not hurt Joe? And then I see this. Why even fucking bother?
Well, apparently they wanted to get rid of the TNA X Division title. They wanted to ensure it will never matter ever again. So they buried the title deeper than ever. They buried Red deeper than ever.
They beat Joe.
Red was more over when he was not wrestling for this company than he is right now.
Yeah. This was, this sucked.
I defy you to name me one person who liked this segment and thought it was good in any way.
Crumbly, are you listening? Is it you? After commercial, Joe went batshit crazy, saying this is what he wore. Lashley's days were numbered. He was screaming and frothing like a fool. I was sitting there wondering why the fuck he was so mad. He asked Lashley to get in the ring in the middle of a championship match. Lashley, what a dumb shit.
Lashley had the temerity to out-wrestle him.
Lashley had the temerity to do what he asked and do it better.
To be fair, Brock Lesnar said his big fall-in with Frank Mir was that Frank beat him.
I guess. I don't know. After commercial, Suicide and Daniels faced the Pope and Homicide. I have no idea why the Pope and Homicide are a team. Homicide is a member of World Elite. He didn't have 10 other guys he could team with.
Except 10 other X Division guys, mind you.
Randomly,
Eric Young,
the Pope.
The Sheik, Kiyoshi, none of those men?
No. So, the Pope didn't even cut a promo, so this was completely useless.
And Suicide didn't get a cool entrance. He just walked down the ramp.
Daniels made a comeback, ran wild on D'Angelo. And in the middle of the comeback, Homicide left the ring, and he went up and started yelling at the Spanish commentators. And apparently the storyline was that Homicide has been doing promos in Spanish, but they have not been PG. And the Spanish announcers tattled on him, and so he got fined, and so he went up to kick their ass in the middle of a match.
Yeah. It suddenly occurred to him this would be a good idea. He did not do it before the show,
no,
or walking down the ramp to the,
no,
match, or after the match.
No.
During the match,
yeah,
he took a move and rolled outside and at least looked at the Spanish announcers and went to kill them.
And then Suicide saved the Mexicans.
Yeah.
So, well, he may be a Mexican. We don't know. He's masked.
Don't know.
He could be Hector Garza.
Perhaps he's a luchador.
So, Homicide distracted Daniels. Pope hit the running knees to the back for the pin. This whole segment was a complete and total mess. This show is Vince Russo. Every single fucking segment has too much stuff going on. Overbooked bullshit. If they'd taken out half of the excess bullshit in every single segment, this probably would have been a pretty damn good show.
No.
But every single segment had to have too much stuff going on.
Well, this was too much stuff. And keep in mind, when you mentioned that Homicide, in the middle of the comeback, went over to beat up the Spanish announcers, what you did not mention was that in the middle of the comeback was 3 minutes into the match.
Oh, yeah. So Angle wanted to know why Nash didn't kill Eric. And Nash said, well, he offered me double. And Angle's like, well, this is about loyalty. I didn't need to offer you anything. I should have asked you to do something. You would have done it for free, but I was nice enough to offer you $30,000. And Nash was like, come on, it's double. He's got a point.
It's undeniable. That is actually double.
Today was in the ring to hype up a four-way tag team ladder match at the pay-per-view.
Double championship tag team ladder match.
Yep. It is four teams, four title belts. If you grab the TNA titles, your team wins those. And if you grab the IWGP titles, your team wins those. Now, why you wouldn't just grab both when you got to the top of the ladder, I don't know. Maybe they're going to be hanging from different areas.
That would make sense.
So the teams were Steiner and Booker, Beer Money, British Invasion, Team 3D, and immediately broke down into a brawl. Fine. Taz is like, well, this always happens in these contract signings. He called it a melee havoc-type situation. This melee havoc-type situation was an extended melee havoc-type situation, which, by the way, should be the name of a WWE-themed pay-per-view. But anyway, they brawled forever. Then they started doing ladder spots. No security. Then they brawled and brawled and brawled. And then I think, like, the Mafia ran some guys off and took some belts. But then after they were playing their music, the brawl continued. The music stopped. The British invasion laid out the Mafia, and then they held up the belts, and then their music played. And I was like, this is one of those brawls that makes me want to see the match even less.
I think actual wars are started and finished in the time it took for this segment to go.
Very possible.
And this is one where we will read the amount of wrestling in the show, and someone will say, well, what about this brawl? I'll say, what about the brawl? It was no good.
And by the way, TNA beat ECW by 2 minutes this week. 2 minutes.
Yeah, so they're having this brawl, and then in the middle of a brawl, somehow Booker ended up on a table, and Robert Roode ended up on a ladder, and was going to jump off the ladder and put Roode through a table. But first, Charmel ran in the way, and then Rob Terry came in and interfered. So yes, you must now keep track of 10 people doing stuff in this segment. It lasted forever. It sucked. Who could care?
Beautiful People, and Alyssa Flash and Tracy against Sarita Taylor and Tracy and Hamada.
Who cares?
Fucked something up. I don't care. Anyway, Taz's first question was, where's Lacey Von Erich? And I thought, that's a goddamn good question. So they have a match. It's an elimination match.
Why?
I don't know.
Because we needed a random women's Survivor Series match for no reason here on Impact.
Yeah. Tracy pinned Christy and then told her Playboy sucked.
That was the only good thing about the match.
Which is actually funny because Christy's Playboy was a million times better than Tracy's. Hamada and Alyssa brawled, countered out and eliminated. And as soon as they were eliminated, they just stopped brawling and walked away. And they showed this on camera. That was awesome.
And the show was not live.
No. Velvet pinned Taylor. Taylor Wilde, mind you, with a DDT, which shocked me, actually. Sarita pinned Tracy. And it came down to Beautiful People against Sarita 2-on-1. Sarita pinned Velvet with a small package. Alyssa came back, took the ref. Lacey booted Sarita in the back. Hit her with the Uranage.
Which at least
was better than the claw. And then I guess Sarita Madison is her name, pinned Sarita. So, too much shit going on.
Yeah, oh, you don't say. You don't say, yes. The Beautiful People came out. They did the Beautiful People entrance, but God bless Madison Rain, but she is not Angelina Love. It's just not the same. So,
There was a great spot, actually, with, speaking of asses, when Velvet was doing a spot with somebody, and she took, like, a snapmare or something, and she managed to take the bump and pull down her skirt at the same time.
When you say pull down her skirt, that sounds like she was doing something lewd. No. The skirt had flipped up, you see.
Yeah, which is designed to do, by the way.
Yeah, it's a skirt designed to show off her body, and she was ensuring it would not do this.
Yes.
While trying to sell.
In the middle of a move.
God bless Velvet Sky. So, yeah, and then Lacey ran in, and she kicked Sarita with the toe of her foot right in the small of the back.
Oh, God.
It looked so bad. And it was a waste of time.
We had some segments with Angle and Mick talking about something or another.
I don't know.
No idea.
Here are my notes for this segment. Foley meets with Angle. Morgan meets with Abyss. Whatever. That's all I wrote.
So Sting came out and cut a promo and said after he and AJ had finished their sit-down interview a few weeks back, he had a long thought about what AJ had said to him. And long story short, he said he still had it in him to win. And at the pay-per-view, he was going to lace the boots up one more time. He was going to bring his best, believing he could still get the job done. By the way, when did this ever become a retirement stipulation?
I think it was this segment.
Okay. All right.
I guess.
Well, why is he talking about lacing him up one more time? So he said that maybe if he went out there and he couldn't do what he wanted to do anymore, it would be showtime for the last time. And then out came Kurt. And by the way, last week when they had the countdown interview, there was a graphic for the Bound for Glory that said Sting's final stand with a question mark. So apparently they jumped the gun by a full week, which, given TNA, this does not surprise me one bit. So Angle came out and said he should have just retired before their scam at the last pay-per-view and said he wanted his rematch. Couldn't believe that AJ was giving it to his buddy on the biggest show of the year. And he said that everybody knew in order to be the best of all time, he had to beat Kurt Angle in the middle of the ring one-on-one, asked him to retire and do everybody a favor so that a real champion could step up to the main event. And anyway, AJ ended up coming out after Angle attacked Sting. And Angle said he wanted his title shot. He was busy at Bound for Glory, but he was not busy next week. So it's Kurt Angle versus AJ Styles on Impact last week. And I won't spoil the match, but I will say apparently it was awesome, if you can believe that.
I can.
Yes.
I can't believe those two had a great match. I'm mildly surprised they were given a chance to. But, yeah, the segment, Sting came out, talked about the match, talked about how important it was, and the retirement thing is ambiguous. I'm not sure where it came from, but he basically said he was happy to have a title match in front of his home crowd, and if he sucked, he should quit. So, okay. Then he walked out, or was starting to walk out, and Kurt came out, and Kurt challenged him, basically said, you have to beat me, and he began to build up Sting versus Angle.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, well, that's odd. They're not wrestling on the pay-per-view. Why are they doing this? Then AJ came out, and they started building up Angle versus AJ. And I thought, well, this is really strange. And then they booked Angle versus AJ for next week, so I guess it's payoff to that, but why do they have Angle? Why do they build up Angle Sting?
I don't know.
Why do they do anything?
I always love where every now and then you actually ask a valid question about Impact. Like 99% of the time you just give up on the show and you don't care, but every now and then they can't help but work you. You become a mark, if for lack of a better term, and you're fooled into asking a question of which there is no good answer. And this was one of those moments.
I have been caught actually thinking about the show.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's probably my fault.
Lauren asked AJ about offering Kurt.
I do think too much in general.
Lauren asked AJ about offering Kurt the title shot next week, and AJ said everyone knew Sting handed him the title, and he had a lot to prove to himself and the fans. And I thought, you know, the guy scripted this, and he's the one that scripted what happened. You know what I mean? Maybe I'm thinking about this too much.
Maybe. All I know is his explanation made sense, and he wants the babyface champion wants to resolve a disputed finish.
Mm-hmm.
And he's perhaps the best wrestler in the company. His opponent is also perhaps the best wrestler in the company. They're going to resolve a disputed finish for the world championship, and it's not on pay-per-view.
Of course not. Well, no, he wants to resolve the finish against Sting as well. He wants to prove that he could beat Sting and not just have Sting hand him championships.
I'm just saying they could have done this the next pay-per-view.
Well, sure, but maybe Sting's going to retire. We don't know.
We don't know.
Motor City Machine Guns came out to introduce their new music, and Shelley said he knew for a fact that their old music was what caused Consequences Creed to barf last week. That made me laugh heartily. They played the new music, which had an accompanying video. It was generally as shitty as the old music. And in the middle of it, Joe ran out, beat him up. That was lame. And then he screamed for Lashley to come out. This was the only appearance of the Machine Guns on this entire show, by the way. So Lashley came out, and they brawled all over. They brawled up towards the Spanish announcer's table. Joe put Lashley on the table, climbed onto a scaffold, and threw a flying elbow. They both ended up on the concrete. And I thought, now how did that feel, you two?
I know.
Bad. Yes.
So, yeah, the Guns came out. They had teased the new music 2 weeks ago during the interrogation angle. They had promised new music last week. Then they began to play the new music. It went for 5 seconds with the video. It at least had a better lyrics. At least now it's an angry guy shouting instead of some happy people.
Yeah, but I love that old music in a sense because it was just like, it was like music you would have if you were going out for a match at the Tokyo Dome. It's just kind of their gimmick. Now this is just your average generic
indie
country guy writing metal songs for Impact,
yes.
Which is exactly what this is.
That is true.
So I apologize for saying their old music sucked because their old music was 10 times better.
Well,
because it fit.
How
them.
Can you tell? We only heard 6 seconds of it.
Their old music?
No, the new music.
And,
well, let's hear more.
Yeah.
But the point I want to get to is they're playing this video, and very quickly into the video, it cuts back to the ramp where Joe runs out and then attacks the Machine Guns.
Yeah.
So apparently the director knew in advance.
Well, Joe probably told him.
I'm going to go out and kill these guys.
Yeah.
Make sure you come back.
Mm-hmm.
And the director said, I can warn them or I can just do what Joe says.
Well, he'd do what Joe says.
Well, when I put it that way, I guess it doesn't make sense. It just came off so dumb.
ODB and Tara for the women's title. They hit each other real hard, either on purpose or on accident.
I think
not
they
sure.
were having an actual fight.
Then Kong came out with a sledgehammer, and she had SoCal Val put the tarantula on the ground so she could kill it. Tara, meanwhile, was in the ring with the fucking worst triangle I've ever seen in the history of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu.
This is not a triangle. This is a rhombus or some other shape.
And Tara broke the hole to save her spider, allowing ODB to hit her with the TKO for the pin. Why Kong did not kill the spider after Tara was laid out, I do not know. Then Angle and Abyss, I'm sorry, I jumped ahead.
I don't
Crowd was dead silent for the spider bullshit, by the way.
They were sort of into the women's match, and then there was an attempted spider side, and the crowd just went dead silent. And it wasn't dead silent like, this is stupid. It was dead silent like, what is going on? Which I don't know if that's better or worse.
It was stupid.
It was definitely silent.
It was stupid. She was trying to kill a spider with a sledgehammer. Come on. Foley and Angle against Morgan and Abyss. Angle and Abyss were going for finishes immediately, which is what happens when you start a match with 4 minutes left in the TV show. So Foley hit Abyss with a barbed wire bat, which I don't know how the referee didn't see this, but Foley is standing on the apron in his spot with a barbed wire bat. He swings it wildly and hits a giant man, and the ref somehow did not see this. So then we had some heat for a while, and then Abyss hit a shock treatment, tagged in Morgan. He ran wild. We had a four-way. And then we had the finish, which was Abyss got the bat, and he got in the ring, and he raised it over his head, and this scared Foley, who turned around and ran into a big boot by Matt Morgan for the pin. What was that? I have no idea. And the show just ended.
Then the show stopped.
Too much shit going on.
This is not the biggest problem of the show, but I'm going to go back and read these finishes. Hernandez beat Kevin Nash by DQ when Eric Young ran in and beat him up. Amazing Red won the X title when Lashley beat up Samoa Joe. Pope pinned Daniels in a tag match after Daniels was distracted by Suicide and Homicide brawling the Spanish announcers. There was a four-way brawl with the tag teams. A women's Survivor Series match ended when Lacey Von Erich interfered. Tara pinned ODB. ODB pinned Tara after Tara was distracted by Awesome Kong.
And a sledgehammer.
And then Matt Morgan pinned Mick Foley after the tease ending with barbed wire.
Yeah.
No one just hit a move and pinned anyone on the entire show.
Of course not. This is bullshit.
This is a terrible, terrible show. I actually feel sad that I don't hate this more. I've lost the capacity of emotion. I am an automaton now.
Yes.
I am a monolith.
You've been a monolith for a long time.
I just observe. I've lost the capability to judge. I can merely observe and record.
You remind me of one of those Easter Island heads.
Yes.
Often.
Yes. Yes.
Let's talk very, very quickly about Global Impact 2.
This is going to make for an awesome image on the Divas Leather Jacket thread, by the way.
This show was an hour long. I liked it much better than Impact. Even more so now that I've reviewed Impact.
It was definitely better than Impact.
It was so different from Impact, it wasn't even funny. They had interviews with all the guys, and they were talking about it like it was a legit sporting event. They were out to prove they were the best and take championships. Perfect.
Huh.
I can imagine Vince Russo watching this and having no earthly idea why anybody would possibly care. Just like we do when we watch Impact. So we had Yujiro and Naito against Motor City Machine Guns for the IWGP Tag Team titles. They had a really good match. And it was a good match. I couldn't call it a really good match. It was edited, I'm sure.
That's true, too.
Poor
Alex
Shelley.
It sucked bad to be Alex Shelley.
He got the shit kicked out of him, bloody nose, leaking everywhere, dropped on his head with a Northern Lights suplex.
If Awesome Kong had hit that spider with a sledgehammer, it still would have been in better shape than Alex Shelley here.
Yeah. But they did hit a double team sliced bread powerbomb for the pin. And this match was, in fact, better than anything on Impact.
By leaps and bounds. Yeah. It's actually better even before the match started, because you don't like the Machine Guns new music. No Limit came out to No Limits by 2 Unlimited. Quality Eurotechno. This made me happy. And they had their match. It was good. Alex Shelley took a horrendous beating. Then they eventually won in the 3-star range.
Yeah.
Good. Do you need to go out of your way to see it? Not really.
No. Nash, Angle, Masachono, and Ricky Choshu against Giant Bernard, Takashi Iizuka, Tomohiro Ishii, and Carl Anderson. Choshu's tights. It's like...
Yes.
His tights are such that they ride really high, like, past his belly button. Like, he pulls them up real high almost to his chest. Yet, at the same time, they're super high cut on the hip, and on the ass, and on the crotch. It's just wrong.
So you're not a fan then?
No. If you're going to hike up your tights real, real high, but like there's still massive coverage of your ass and your genitals, like Nikolai Volkov, for example, that's all fine. But when you like have the what do they call it? The bikini cut. You got bikini cut on the bottom, and they're still hiked up past your navel. Just unacceptable. Chono was fantastic. Chono, and this is one of the reasons that I actually feel that I, in some ways, am a. I learned a lot from Chono, because of course Buddy Wayne and Chono worked like 30 days in a row, month after month in the Maritimes, and then Buddy taught me all he knew. And Buddy, many, many times has, we did tag matches, and guys would go for a tag on the other team, or they would go to tag Buddy, and they would slap his hand as hard as possible. Mm-hmm. And he would just look at his hand, as if to say, why did you slap my hand so fucking hard? It's fake, you're just making a tag. Chono did a tag in this match, where, I think it was, who was over there?
I was not paying attention, but someone...
I think it was Choshu.
Choshu dragged someone back to the corner, and he wanted to tag out, because Chono was actually in the ring at first.
Yeah.
And Choshu wanted to tag out to him. He looked around, and he said, hey, get over here and tag me. So Chono climbed onto the apron.
He got on the apron, and he reached over the top rope. And I guess the best term I could use is he stroked Choshu.
He
petted him like he would pet a baby kitten.
He nuzzled him with the back of his knuckles.
Yes.
That
was, in fact, the tag.
It was,
because you see, everybody, a tag is making contact with your partner. You touch a part of your body to a part of his, mm-hmm. in most cases hand to hand, although I'm sure in some places it's... Anyway, you touch your partner, and then thus it is now your turn to get into the ring. You don't have to slap him.
No noise is needed.
You don't have to chop him in the hand. You don't have to strike him with such fury that you can hear the tag in the upper boxes. You just have to make contact with your partner. The referee has to see it, and then you're allowed to switch. This is what Choshu did.
This is
why he's great.
It was literally a tender moment. He reached out. He touched the back of his knuckles to Choshu's shoulder, and he entered the ring. And that was that. Yeah, it was... They had a match. It was good. It was not as good as the opener. It was, I don't know, 2.5. I had not seen Carl Anderson in years. He looked totally different. It was still weird to see him wrestling Kurt Angle.
Yeah.
That was just bizarre. And I watched this and I thought to myself, remind me again why Giant Bernard is not in WWE.
He's a little fat.
Is that really the reason?
Well, he's probably having more fun in Japan, quite frankly.
He may be having more fun, I buy that, but yeah. He may prefer it there, but it just seems so strange, this enormous guy.
That was not even the strangest thing. As far as why are people where they are, Kurt Angle is tailor-made for New Japan, just Japan in general.
Yeah.
He was put on this earth to be a Japanese pro wrestler. He was so totally in his element here. He was awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And then you watch some of the shit he does on Impact, and it's like, poor fucker.
Well, you could argue his entire career has been an enormous waste.
Yeah.
From start to finish. But it was just watching, I mean, Giant Bernard and Nash started, and they had a stare down, and Bernard's like 2 inches shorter. And then he started to move, and it's like, I had not seen him in years. Holy shit!
Oh, he's improved dramatically.
Well, I'm sure he's also much better than he used to be, but he was always athletically gifted.
Yeah.
I'm sure as a wrestler, he's much better, but just watching him run the ropes and stuff, I was like, holy Christ! What is this guy not doing? He's bigger and much better than Kane.
Yeah. So they did this and that, and then Angle tapped out Anderson with the ankle lock, and they immediately cut away, because apparently there was a post-match angle they did not want to show. And so they had to immediately cut away after the 3 count. And then we had Team 3D against Togi Makabe and Toriyano. Toriyano, I'm sorry. People get very upset if I exchange an O for a U.
Well, it makes you feel better. I wrote Toriyano and another guy.
I love how Mike Tenay always brings up that, for example, Team 3D is undefeated in the Orient.
It's 2009.
The Orient. It's quite a collection of physiques in this battle. It's also a hardcore match. They use tables, chairs. Apparently the fans live had no idea what to make of this match. And
frankly, I didn't either, really.
Makabe took a superplex to a table and a big fat splash from Bubba and kicked out. And Devon was bleeding as he is wont to do. And finally, Makabe tried a clothesline with a chain. Devon ducked. Makabe ran right into a 3D, got pinned. So basically, for those of you, if you did not hear the shows the last couple of days and weren't aware of what's going on, Team 3D beat Togi Makabe and Toriyano to win a set of titles that they've already lost, And the Motor City Machine Guns beat Yujiro and Naito for a set of tag team title belts, so they have also already lost.
Yeah, this was taped in, like, January, wasn't it?
December.
Even better.
This was taped in 2008.
Because there was a line from Alex Shelley saying, a win here would be a great way to start off the year. I was a little confused as to...
And it was TNA and Don West, by the way.
And Don West was on commentary. Perhaps he was using the Mayan calendar? I wasn't sure.
I don't know.
But, yeah, this was actually... I wasn't terrible.
It was a fine show.
But I just mean this match, but they didn't even build any of the weapon spots. They just, let's use a trayer.
Well, do you really think that these guys, I mean, it's one thing for Team 3D, but Makabe and Toriyano, you think they're doing a whole bunch of hardcore matches on a regular basis?
Probably not. Probably not. They're smart. They set up a table, then somebody went to it.
Yeah.
Then they kept wrestling.
Yeah.
All right.
So anyway, that was the Global Impact show. It was a fun show. Not necessarily a show you need to go out of your way to see.
You do not need to go out of your way to see it. In fact, if I had this on my DVR, I guess you could watch it. I won't say you must skip it.
You just watch it just to see how different guys like Angle and the Machine Guns and such are when they're allowed to go to Japan and just have good wrestling matches as opposed to overbooked tripe.
This was better than any Impact in the past, I don't know, year.
I don't know about that.
There have been a few good impacts.
There were actually a couple of good impacts before they canned Cornette.
To the back!
Angle came out with the Main Event Mafia for a promo.
I got a good one.
That's not a joke, by the way. This actually happened. Impact opened with yet another Main Event Mafia promo. He noted it was their one-year anniversary coming up.
Actually, you missed the part where they said that Bound for Glory was their biggest show in history.
Oh, they said that, yeah. They said that about 100 times. It's a lie. No one cares about it. So he said that it was the one-year anniversary of the Mafia, and I thought about where they are 1 year later, and it's really kind of sad when you think about it. So he said that Kevin Nash will beat Eric Young and Hernandez in their three-way, and that's really the first time it occurred to me. That match is going to happen on pay-per-view. Kevin Nash versus Eric Young versus Hernandez in a three-way. Good Lord.
I got to interrupt you here very quickly, because you mentioned a second ago that nobody cares about Bound for Glory. I'm just going to give my speech now about...
cut to the chase.
I'm just going to cut to the chase about the Bound for Glory hype special at the end of the show. So they had this Bound for Glory hype special, and as everybody is well aware, it was a blatant ripoff. Unrepentantly, they ripped this off, and they'll tell you that, from the UFC countdown specials for their pay-per-views. And they talked to Lashley, they went to his gym, they saw him training, they showed his wife, they showed his buggers, he talked about MMA, he talked about pro wrestling, they talked to all of the participants in the major matches, they talked to Sting, they had Dixie Carter talking about how every year Sting says it's the end, but she gets him for one more year, and this year she doesn't really know if she's going to get him for another year, which, by the way, is a lie. Talked to Kurt Angle and Matt Morgan. Morgan talked about it's the most important thing in his life, even more so than his wife and family, he admitted. And Kurt Angle talking about how important this is, now he wants it to be the best match he can possibly have, and Angle and Abyss and Foley and all these people talking about the matches, all saying the right things, very well produced. And in many ways, a fantastic video package. I mean, they did a very, very good job creating a hype special for Bound for Glory. Crumbly on the board, a big TNA fan, after he watched this, he went on the board and he posted that he was really, really sad that he wasn't going to make it out for Bound for Glory this year. It was the first one he'd never went to, and he was very upset after watching the hype special. And when it was over, I just thought, are you really? Like, you watch that hype special, and are you really disappointed that you can't see Bound for Glory? Let me explain. When you see a great hype special for WrestleMania, for example, this, of course, is supposed to be TNA's version of WrestleMania, which after all of these years, it still doesn't have that feeling. It feels like your average TNA pay-per-view.
It's their October pay-per-view.
They just put more effort into hyping this particular pay-per-view. It does not seem like the WrestleMania of pay-per-views. WrestleMania, of course, has their hype specials every year or whatever they do, or they plug WrestleMania really hard. And in the last couple of years, they haven't done really all that great a job. But even when they don't do all that great a job hyping up the pay-per-view, it still does a shitload of buys. And the reason for that is because people know it's WrestleMania. And people know that at WrestleMania, all of the wrestlers are going to pull out all of the stops. All of the wrestlers are going to try to have a match for the ages. All the wrestlers are going to do everything they can do to try to steal the show. And I can't remember the last WrestleMania that I watched where, when it was over, I thought, what a horrible show that was. I don't even remember the last one. You'd have to go back a hell of a long way, actually, to find a lackluster WrestleMania. With UFC, you watch a hype special, and, you know, maybe you don't know the two guys, but you watch them talk shit to each other and this and that, and you get excited, and you're okay seeing the pay-per-view because in a fight, anything can happen. We've got Lyoto and Shogun Hua coming up. I would guess that 9 out of 10 UFC fans don't give a shit about that main event. But you know what? It could be great. You don't know. You have no idea what's going to happen with those two guys. So if you see two guys talking shit on a UFC hype special, and you really want to see them beat each other up, you may as well buy the show because there's a good chance it's going to be an exciting fight, or at least there's the possibility always that it's going to be an exciting fight. That brings us to the Bound for Glory pay-per-view special. As noted, it was a really good special. It was well produced. All the guys said the right things. It was very different from your average goofy TNA show. But at the end of the day, whether I'm right about this or not, perhaps I'm wrong, but it doesn't matter. Whether I'm right about this or not, all I know is that I feel like on Sunday, I'm not going to get WrestleMania. I'm going to get another TNA pay-per-view. I buy every single TNA pay-per-view. Every single one. Vince, you come over and watch every single TNA pay-per-view.
That's true.
Regardless of how great this video package was, as a regular buyer of TNA, I know what I'm going to get on Sunday. Therefore, I don't care.
That is correct.
It is going to be just another TNA pay-per-view. And the sad thing is, no matter how great a hype special they create, They could have the UFC or the HBO 24/7 people come in and create a hype special. It doesn't matter to me because I buy all the pay-per-views and I always get the same thing. That was the failure of this show.
May I summarize this in one sentence? No matter how hard you try to polish a turd, it's still a turd.
I think my speech was better.
Mine was certainly more crass.
Not to mention, there was a bigger problem on the show, and that was that we had Kurt Angle versus AJ Styles in a 20-minute draw without any commercial breaks. There was a legitimate 4-star match, maybe 4 1/4. It was a fucking great match. And when it was over, I'm supposed to pay for AJ Styles and Sting?
Or Kurt Angle versus Matt Morgan.
What? When this show was over, I wanted to see exactly one match in TNA. AJ Styles and Kurt Angle in a rematch for the title.
With no time limit.
Guess what I'm not getting?
That one. Yes, they're dumb. They're a dumb, dumb company.
I mean, I at least understand that that's where they're going next, but okay.
Yeah, they made it in the show. The best match on their TV show this year was spent to build up next month's pay-per-view.
I don't know. I can't find the drop right now. It's somewhere in this entire thing. But everybody, I'm sure, that's listened to this show for any length of time remembers when there was a UFC conference call. And at the end of the conference call, they go to Dave. Dave is unprepared. He's madly scrambling for his phone and for his notes and for whatever else. And he stutters and he stumbles along and then he finally gets his question out. And his question to Randy Couture is basically, you know, are you looking past this fight, was essentially the question.
It was really more, after Brock beats you, will he beat everyone else?
Well, he didn't really say that, but he was just saying, you know, what do you think? He's just asking him to look past this fight here, and Randy's like, it would be ridiculous for me to look past this fight. And there's a pause, Dave says thank you, there's a moment of silence, they're about to wrap it up, and Brock all of a sudden just says, well, that was a stupid question. Why would you be hyping up a match for a pay-per-view after the biggest pay-per-view of the year? I hate to complain about Angle and AJ because it was so great, but they spent 20 nonstop commercial-free minutes setting up a match that I can't see at the biggest pay-per-view of the year. This is mind-boggling to me. Why would you do
Not
this?
Not me. It's part of the... Hey, I in fact, they're building up a match that I want to see that I presumably next month I will get. Usually, they do stuff I'm left not wanting to ever see it again.
Yes.
This is a step in the right direction.
It is a step in the right direction, I guess.
It's taken them 7 years to get here. Or however long it's been.
Why isn't Angle just getting the title shot on Sunday? He went to a draw with the guy and had him in his finishing hold when the time limit expired. How are we supposed to possibly care about Matt Morgan after this? And then what happens? Matt Morgan beats Kurt? Then what? Now we're going to have a three-way or like another four-way with AJ, Sting, Kurt, and Matt Morgan? I don't want to see that. I want to see the singles match without a time limit again.
But they're dumb. You know, the more I think about this, the more I think we mean I'll get that. Because you're right. They probably will do a four-way next month.
Oh, God.
Or a tag match where the winner of the fall gets the title.
Oh, yeah, sure. Something stupid. Let's get back to the show here. We had a beautiful people against Tara, ODB, and Kong in a six-woman tag.
Well, I do want to just get back to the opening real quick. Short version, Kurt Angle said all his guys would win their matches. And then, like, nine good guys came out on the ramp, and then they came down and beat him up.
That's right.
They had him outnumbered, like, 2-1.
We had a brawl, yeah.
Then the beautiful people came out.
ODB, Kong, and Tara, who, of course, last week were all feuding. Now they're teaming. Who put this fucking match together?
A retard.
Someone who hated these women?
And me. They hate me.
So, of course, Kong turned on her partners, so it went down to Tara and ODB 2-on-3, but they never let Lacey tag in.
In theory, yes.
Yeah, so Lacey stood on the apron the entire time, and then finally Tara and ODB got in a fight. Tara super kicked her, Velvet got the pin, and afterwards, the best part of this by far was when all of the beautiful people are in the ring, they turn their backs to the cameras, they bend over to show their asses, and Lacey almost trips and falls down.
They're supposed
fabulous.
To. Yes, they bend over to show their asses, and they're supposed to sort of stand up slowly and sexily, and Lacey almost fell over and just popped right back up.
Yes. Then we have the Pope doing a promo, a great promo as always. He mm-hmm. plugged his six-hour power.
Twice.
Lauren mentioned Homicide was suspended. I presumed at the point it was due to attacking the Spanish announcers. They didn't bother announcing that until after this interview. That was a good one. And anyway, I don't know what he said, but it was awesome.
All I can tell you is that he did plug his energy shot twice. He did at one point confirm that Lauren had clean hands and then placed her hand on his heart and then accused her of getting freaky or something. And he's great. He needs to be cutting promos like this every week and then having matches every week.
And someone needs to make some songs with the Pope. Everybody keeps bitching about great Kali songs and Iron Sheik songs. I'm just playing what people send me. All right? If you're going to bitch, then go onto your little Winamp or whatever your thing is and create a great song not involving great Kali or the Iron Sheik. And if you're not going to do that, then shut the fuck up.
So we had this really, really awesome Pope promo. And the very next segment was another promo by Bobby Lashley.
Oh, yeah.
This was a dumb idea.
Well, no, it wasn't really, because Rhino immediately speared him, so we didn't have to hear his promo.
In the 10 words he spoke, he had so much negative charisma, especially following the Pope, is my point here.
Yeah.
It made you realize how boring Bobby Lashley is.
Yeah. We had Red come out to defend the X Division title, and who should show up with him but Don West, his new manager, and he was out there being a nutty cheerleader. It was quite awesome, and Red did a big tornado dive, and then Suicide cut him off and was going up for the finish, and then the Pope ran down and shoved him off for the cheap DQ, and I was going to keep track of the shitty finishes on the show, but I just didn't care enough and gave up.
Yeah, I know. I tried that once. It's painful sometimes. In fact, we'll just take note if there is a clean finish on the show.
Well, actually, the draw, that was about it.
I guess
it,
that was a clean finish, but yes. So then after this, they had a promo backstage where Don West was being a manager and cutting a promo talking about how great Red was. And whoever thought of putting Don West in to speak for Amazing Red? 5-star idea.
Yes.
This
was the greatest role a human being has ever had in this business.
Yes.
No more perfect role for a human being than Don West. He was like an old school, awesome, great manager here. Don West! It was fabulous.
He talked about how awesome Red was, how perfect he was suited for the Ultimate Mex match, how he couldn't believe Red had never been in one of these because he was so perfectly for it.
Yeah.
Then he said that his man was going to win.
He was so great that Red was actually fired up.
Yeah. Red never speaks except that one crappy promo he cut like 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
And yes, he got Red so excited that Red went, yeah!
Yeah. It was great.
It was awesome. So, yay Don West.
Eric Young came out and did commentary. Thankfully, only commentary. And reiterated that they had won. Great.
Again, I mentioned this with Pope and Lashley, but we had the great Don West promo, and then Eric Young comes out and mumbles something about winning a war.
Yeah.
Just, I don't care about this man at all.
It was Hernandez against all of the British invasion in a gauntlet match. Why? I don't know. But it was. So, he beat Doug Williams, and then he beat Bruce Magnus.
He beat Doug Williams with a shoulder block, by the way.
And then he beat Rob Terry. All I know is that there was a nerd in the front row. This guy that was like just a nerd. I mean, there's no other way to explain it. He was a really, really skinny guy in a white T-shirt.
Yes, he made himself look super skinny.
Black horn-rimmed glasses. And he was just a nerd. And he was such a nerd that, like, he made everybody else in the front row of the Impact Zone look like they completely had it together. It was an amazing thing. Wrestling promoters could learn something about booking from seeing the nerd and the effect he had on the surrounding men. Anyway, this match was what it was, and Terry's gimmick is that he flexes repeatedly. That's all he does.
I know I've said this before, but he looks exactly like a He-Man toy come to life.
Yeah.
The exact same proportions as the He-Man doll from 1984 or whatever.
And then Young hit the ring and beat the shit out of Hernandez with a kendo stick, and the people said, boo, and so
that included me, yeah. Yes. You know, the best line Eric had on commentary was, he was talking about how strong Hernandez was, and he said, what he lacks is intelligence, and he has that in spades. So Eric Young on commentary, a disaster.
Then we had a pre-taped deal with TNA, Brother Ray, Booker T, Brutus Magnus, and Robert Roode, all four of these guys were, like, in a different room, and it was being beamed to a big screen. First off...
It's like the Brady Bunch, yes.
What a clusterfuck. You couldn't just get four chairs. So
I also love that they were each identified as the captain of their team.
Oh, yeah.
Does a tag team need a captain?
Sure. So the captains are all there, and they're all bitching back and forth, and suddenly TNA is screaming that their partners are all in a big brawl at catering. So the guys all just up and left. And we got the second huge brawl on the show so far, and they hit each other with ladders and chairs and tables, and
if any of you think that sounds in any way exciting, we apologize for failing to accurately describe it. You've never seen eight large men have such a boring, useless brawl.
Indeed. AJ did a promo about how he was the TNA heavyweight champion. He was great. Said he had to leave no doubt in his match with Kurt Angle tonight. So, of course, you know what that means. We had D'Angelo, De Niro, and Chris Daniels. De Niro has an entrance where money drops from the ceiling. Cash money. And all these fans were reaching up, and they were all excited, and they grabbed them, and then they just gave them to their friends. Because you see, it's not real money. It is fake money with De Niro's face on it. So they had a really fun little match, actually. And Daniels ran wild and got cut off and ran wild and made a comeback and this and that. And finally, they did the double bridge up spot, and Daniels turned it into the Angel's Wing. So we got the first clean pin of the evening.
That is true, yes.
This gets the F4W seal of approval.
This was, at the time, the best thing on the show by leaps and bounds.
Yep.
It would not finish that way. But, yes, we had a very fun Pope promo. This is a fun little Pope match. It went perhaps 5, maybe even 6 minutes, which on TNA is an eternity. And I had no complaints. And then afterwards, they had an actual fun angle.
They had Suicide run down, and he teased going after D'Angelo. But then he attacked Daniels, gave him the Gringo Killer, unmasked his Homicide, and they sent a bunch of security dudes to chase him off. And he was all but screaming, fuck the police.
That would have made it better.
I mean, he came as close to screaming that as he could without actually screaming it. But if you watched him flee, you knew this was what he was screaming in his head. This was great. And then Foley came out with some popcorn and did a promo on Abyss, and he showed some videos of Abyss being a cheap Mick Foley ripoff. And finally, Abyss came out to just end the festivities, and he had a barbed wire bat. And Foley had a recliner and popcorn and a clicker because he was watching this stuff on the big screen. And as Abyss is running the ring with a barbed wire bat, Foley is just sitting there, I guess figuring that Abyss is not going to do anything. So first off, what a fool.
Well, and it's TNA, so that actually made sense to me. I expected Abyss to get in the ring and just, like, weld his bat menacingly. But No. He charged in, he strode across the ring, and he put the barbed wire into Mick Foley's throat.
Yes.
So that made me laugh.
So Foley all of a sudden tells him, I have one more video for you, and the video is of Dr. Stevie having supposedly kidnapped Lauren, and Foley told Abyss she was in trouble, he better go save her. So Abyss ran off. And I was going to say that was that, but that is not that.
No.
We'll have more on that later.
There was more. So this that was fine. It was kind of wacky. Why and how Foley needed an easy chair for this angle, I don't know. But they showed clips of, like, Abyss going through fire, and Foley says, hey, that's a spot Edge and I did in our match of the year, which is a strange line to use in the show. But
yes, he did say that.
He did say that. He pointed out that he showed Abyss debuting with Sinister Minister and saying, hey, I once had a creepy manager and a cheap leather mask, too. So it all set up fine that Foley has a point, basically. Abyss is stealing from him.
Then we had the Homicide promo backstage, claimed he'd beaten up Suicide in the locker room, stolen his outfit, and he said he knew who was under the mask, said he was an ugly motherfucker, but they could keep it their little secret. And then suddenly the geeks showed up and confiscated him and dragged him out of the building, and it sucked to be poor Homicide. Yako Amada and Alyssa Flash, false count anywhere, with a 10-minute time limit. Why?
TNA.
Why
TNA.
Not?
TNA.
So they had a hell of a little match, actually. Fought around ringside, did a spot off the ramp where Hamada did a flip dive, and ended up with her putting Alyssa on a table and then hitting a moonsault off the post for the pin. And I have no idea why this match took place. I have no idea why it was false count anywhere. I have no idea, but it was fun.
It was fun for what it was.
We should
not complain.
One thumb up.
This was definitely a win all in all. But again, we don't know why the match was happening or any of that stuff. One other note on the Foley segment, but that match, the Foley and Abyss match at the pay per view is going to be Monsters Ball. The four way tag match is going to be Full Metal Mayhem.
Mm-hmm.
What is the difference?
Well, they can't call it a TLC match. Copyrighted.
I see. So that's going to be a ladder match with a bunch of other stuff.
And ladders, tables, ladders, chairs.
So
and chains.
And Foley and Abyss are going to have different weapons, I guess.
Yeah.
But they still have to pin each other.
Then we had a angle promo where we began to try to figure out which hominid angle most resembled.
Our friend who was with us noticed he had a prominent skull ridge, suggesting he has powerful jaw muscles for consuming tubers. There's nothing better.
Cackled.
There's nothing better than watching wrestling with non-wrestling fans.
Yes, especially those that understand human evolution.
Especially those who have knowledge in,
anthropology.
Anthropology, yes.
Sure. So, yes, he looks like he is not yet fully evolved, which is, I guess it's interesting because at one point he did look quite a bit like an ape. When he was all jacked to the gills early on in WWE and looked rather ape-like, and now he's just starting to look like a primitive man. So I guess we'll see what happens as he ages. He may, by the time he's 90, look like an alien.
Perhaps he'll just have fur. Oh, I see.
He'll have a giant head with large almond-shaped eyes. So we had Lashley and Rhino.
Like Jenna Jameson.
And Lashley's ribs were all taped up from the beating earlier. And this is a stretcher match, by the way.
Yes, again.
Again. Why not?
Why
not? That's my new... Instead of asking why with Impact, I just ask, why not? Why not have a stretcher match here on this go-home show for Bound for Glory? So, and by the way, I hate stretcher matches. I was thinking about this during the match.
This answers your question of why not, by the way, because they're lame.
A stretcher match, even if they built this up correctly, all right, I still don't like stretcher matches because... The way a stretcher match is nowadays is you hit a guy with some shit, you put him on a table with wheels, and you wheel him over a line. It's like a game you would do on field day at elementary school. A stretcher match should be, you beat this fucker so bad that he can't stand up, he can't roll over, he can't get to his knees, he needs to be placed on a backboard, taken to an ambulance into the medical facility as soon as humanly possible. That's what a fucking stretcher match should be. So anyway, they had the shitty version of the stretcher match, and Lashley's got his ribs taped, and they're beating each other all over, and finally he puts Rhino on the... He slams him on a guardrail, puts him on the stretcher, wheels him into the ambulance, and they zoom off very quickly, leaving Lashley there, at which point our friend noted that, why did they leave the guy with the broken rib standing there, and they took the other guy away? Which was, in fact, an excellent question.
It was a good question. I do like, though, because most stretcher matches, I mean, WWE actually literally now has a finish line for the stretcher matches.
Mm-hmm.
This one, they threw Rhino into an ambulance, which then zoomed off.
Yeah.
That made it better.
Yeah.
But my other big complaint here was there were a couple times, well, once I guess they were only by the door, But a couple of times where it looked like Lashley was about to win, like at any second may push Rhino over and win the match, and they would cut to a replay.
Of course.
Dumb! Bad television.
We had a after-commercial Joe hit Lashley with an object and then fake choked him out in the trainer's room where there was a random unconscious man laying there.
Yes. Welcome to Orlando.
Abyss finally found Lauren, but as it turns out, it was not Lauren who they had kidnapped. It was actually the crazy chick Daphne in disguise. And so Abyss got jumped by Foley and Stevie, and they stomped a mud hole in him. Which begs a very important question. Where was Lauren for the last hour? She was here at the beginning of the show, and then suddenly there was an angle where she was supposedly kidnapped, at which point she was never seen again. They replaced her in all of her backstage segments. What was she doing?
Oh, you are right. I had not thought of this. But I don't
Where was she the whole time?
She must have gone to get food.
She went to get food and alerted nobody?
No.
She wasn't watching this backstage and called Abyss to say, hey, I'm not actually kidnapped, another blonde? This was stupid.
Yes. Yes, it was. There was also, after the Joe and Lashley segment, they air the pay-per-view plug where the guys have pictures in their banners, and it says Joe versus Lashley, TNA versus MMA. I guess Joe better win.
I'm still thinking about this. Lauren deal.
Well,
it just amazes me because they're scripting this show, and they do the Foley segment, and then they've got a segment coming up that involves somebody getting interviewed, and so somebody probably said Lauren interviews so and so, and then Russo jumps in and says, "Well, it can't be Lauren. She's kidnapped," and then the other guy goes, "Well, she's not really kidnapped." And so Russo's like, well, we have to pretend she's kidnapped, so she can't do this interview. So the other guy goes, so where is Lauren? And Russo's like, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. I picture the term, it doesn't matter, being brought up repeatedly in these creative meetings. And then they just moved on, waiting for me to ask, well, where the fuck was Lauren for the last hour? And she was never on the show again afterwards either. So why didn't they just really kidnap her?
Because that was not the plot. I don't know.
Why did they need a fake Lauren? Why didn't they just kidnap the real deal?
Well, because that would be mean. I don't know, Brian. I don't have a good answer.
Maybe they did kidnap her, actually.
And use Daphne as bait?
Sure. She was just a decoy just so they could, so we would be fooled.
So she was a decoy for the decoy.
Yeah.
A swerve to set up the swerve.
Uh-huh.
Hmm. This is reaching meta levels of thought that I am frankly not comfortable with.
AJ Styles and Kurt Angle, TNA title. It was awesome.
They had a really good match.
20 minutes.
Go out of your way to see this.
4 stars.
Yeah.
I don't know what to say. What can I say? This match was awesome.
It was 50 minutes or so, maybe more.
It was 20 minutes because it was a 20-minute draw.
Oh, yeah, you're right. So it was 20 minutes. I don't think AJ Styles broke a sweat. And he was wrestling hard.
Well, he did.
So, yeah, it was really good, as I noted, and I rarely say this, but you should go out of your way to see this match.
Yeah.
And it was on free TV, so I'm sure it'll be on their website or YouTube or something.
The best Impact segment in a long fucking ass time. Years, maybe, actually. So, yeah, as noted, Angle had him in the ankle lock, and he had scissored the leg. It was about to be over. The time limit expired. So then, of course, later we had interview with AJ, where he was very, very sad. Said he had so much shit to still prove to himself and this and that. And then the interviewed Angle, who was all confident, saying, I just beat the TNA champion. Now I'm going to beat Matt Morgan, which, of course, had me thinking, well, you're not going to beat Matt Morgan. And now this whole title picture is going to be all muddled, and I don't want that. I just want to see this match again. So anyway, that kind of made me upset. But and then, of course, we had the Bound for Glory preview special. I talked about that earlier. So that was the Impact show. As noted, if you get a chance, I guess there are no more replays. They've axed the replay, so you can't get a replay of this, and it sucks to be you.
Drag.
So, yeah, if you didn't see the AJ Angle match, I don't know what to tell you, except that I don't know what to tell you.
I don't know. So in the Bound for Glory High special, we got perhaps 2 seconds of Krystal Marshall, and in this 2 seconds, she was still hotter than anyone else in wrestling today. We had Samoa Joe being the old-school Samoa Joe, where he just sat there and calmly explained why he was such a badass. And they mixed it up with recent clips of him screaming and spitting into the camera, and it made you realize how dumb the new version of Joe is.
No shit.
Yeah.
Thanks.
But we had...
I haven't been saying that for 4 years.
We had Abyss and Foley doing point-counterpoint, and Mick Foley was just being Mick Foley, discussing what it means to be hardcore and how he wanted to have the best match. And Abyss was just being Abyss, and he had his hood over his head, and he was growling and giggling, and it was hokey and phony. And in this particular environment where they were trying to do the hype special, it came off as very, very lame.
Well, you see, Vince, The Undertaker has to always be in character.
The Undertaker is much, much better than Abyss, including at this kind of stuff.
Not at promos lately.
I don't know that I agree.
Hold on a second.
Abyss screams too much.
Abyss is fucking awesome promos for like the last 3 weeks on television. You're going to say that that's better than Undertaker's stupid-ass promo where he comes out and says he's going to steal a man's soul at the pay-per-view?
The last promo he did was certainly very dull and pointless.
Which one?
I guess they are all like that, aren't they? I don't like Abyss screaming. You are better, more of a fan of that than I am.
He's great. He's a great man.
There's also clips of Sting, including shots of him as the Blade Runners, and then as Power Team USA.
That's right. That was awesome.
That was awesome. Awesome. I don't think I've actually seen the Power Team stuff, but it was that part was great. But the general theme here is if you're going to go with this sort of sit down UFC ripoff hype special, all the guys who came off as good were the guys who were calm. No one sat down in a chair and started screaming and came off as effective. Joe was effective because he was speaking calmly. Sting was effective because he was believable. That's my point. Foley was believable. Abyss, silly. AJ's just kind of a bad promo anyway. The shots of Joe from today screaming was lame. Morgan was okay. He's a jock in a gym. He works out a lot. Bryan has applied a monocle, or a bottle cap, stuck to his eye. He's as bored as I am. So, yes, it was hit and miss, the hype special. But, again, am I more excited for Bound for Glory than I was going to the hype special? No.
Well, I guess I'm slightly more excited. It's Bound for Glory. They're going to try something wacky.
That sounds horrible.
I don't know. That's the special, everybody. To the back! Bryan Alvarez and young Vincent here for a Sunday night post-TNA Bound for Glory pay-per-view recap show. It was Bound for Glory, 2009. It was TNA's version of WrestleMania. And it was not an awful show. There was some awful stuff on the show. But it picked up there in the last couple of matches. It had a strange finish in many ways. And everybody worked hard, in some cases too hard. And I guess in the end, I have to give it a thumbs in the middle. Not the worst pay-per-view I've ever seen from TNA. Not the best TNA pay-per-view. At the end of the day, exactly as I predicted on the Bryan and Vinny show on Thursday night, when we talked about the countdown special, how they did a great job with the countdown special. But at the end of the day, I still knew what I was going to get on Sunday. And it was not enough to make me want to pay the $49 for this show. Yes, it was $49 in HD. I only spent $39, thank God. But still, it was an advanced price, a more expensive show. And in the end, it really was not worth $40 to me. But I think it was worth a good $20, I'd say.
Yeah, it was kind of a weird show in that, first of all, there's a lot of matches where I just didn't know how to rate it. Usually because it was a good match, but it ruined for me because there was just guys doing too much stupid stuff. And I rated it as best I could, and I looked back and I thought, boy, that's a lot of like 3-star matches on this. But I do not feel like I've enjoyed the show that much. So it somehow was a show that somehow added up to less than the sum of its parts.
It was in Irvine, California. They sold 850 tickets in the week leading up to this show. And I think they had the building set up for 1,500, and apparently they packed the place by the time all was said and done, so that was good. It was not packed for the pre-show, as there were empty seats visible right in front of the hard camera.
In fact, as many empty seats as full seats.
It was incredible, and they eventually filled those up, so it wasn't too bad. But there was a replacement, as the Pope ended up not being able to make the show. He had a family emergency. And so the pre-show match, which was the Machine Guns versus Jay Lethal and Consequences Creed, was a rushed match where the winners went into the X Division, however many way it was, and ended up with the Machine Guns winning clean in a good match, not great. It was 2.5 stars, I guess. They had about 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. They did the best they could in 5 minutes, but really it was actually, I shouldn't even say they did the best they could in 5 minutes. They did a very basic opening match. It was simple. It told a simple story. I don't have a problem with it, but it was a 2.5-star opener.
Yes, it was. The most notable thing is that the Machine Guns, I think for the first time, worked total babyfaces.
Yeah.
The heels, which would be Creed and Lethal, They got the heat on Shelley. He made a hot tag to Sabin. He made a big comeback. And then both teams went back and forth for a bit. And then the Machine Guns hit a big double-team combo move and won. And I don't think they did a single near fall. It was so basic. And I approve of this, by the way.
Yeah.
This definitely gets a thumbs up.
This was the night of the fans in Irvine deciding who they were going to cheer, who they were going to boo, and that was the end of that. And there were a couple of matches where it didn't really quite work out so well because, for example, in the Lashley match, he was supposed to be the babyface, but Samoa Joe was super over as a babyface, and they booed Lashley, and Joe still got the heat on him, which was fascinating. But all up and down the show, there were interesting reactions. Nobody bothered to make a Bizarro World reference, but you know in WWE it would have happened. But here they just let the fans do what they wanted to do and didn't bury them for it, and so that was fine. We had Zach Wilde playing the national anthem on the electric guitar. I always wonder what Ben Franklin, for example, would have thought had he witnessed this. But he did a fine job, and later he did a much better job as an actual participant in a match. But we'll talk about that after a while.
We watched the show with our buddy Craig showed up, who loves the rock and roll, he does. And he made sure he spelled Zach Wilde's name correctly, and he played this anthem here, and it was pretty cool. But then later we found out there was a guy from Boyz II Men in the crowd, and then Craig was appalled that Zach Wilde did the anthem while this guy just sat there.
I also liked, Craig was talking about some shirt that Alex Shelley was wearing. I forget what band it was or whatever. And Craig's like, yeah, they were really big in the early 70s. And you said, I've never heard of them. And Craig goes, they were really big underground.
I don't know what that means either.
Well, it means they were really big, but
below
they weren't.
The surface of the earth?
Yeah. They were really big amongst almost no one. Like this show, for example.
But those who knew...
Exactly.
They knew.
Exactly.
Right? You know, that kind of does fit this show, if you think about it. I also like the, as he was playing his guitar, they panned the crowd, and I've said some mean things about the TNA fans in Orlando. I'm also going to say some mean things about the TNA fans in Irvine. No, I'm not going to, but, boy.
Because you have a friend there who was one of them.
Actually, I got a text here. I thought at first it might have been from Sean, but I think later it was from our buddy Jubbs.
Yeah, Jubbs was texting me throughout the show.
Yeah, so I just got the one. But, yeah, these were not the cream of the crop of humanity.
We had a lot of fans actually at the show sending us messages all night about various things, and it was entertaining. We had Ultimate X, Alex Shelley, Chris Sabin, Suicide Homicide, Red, and Chris Daniels. By the way, three participants were named Suicide, Homicide, and Red. So they had this match, and it was a... 6-man Ultimate X match, quote, to an absolute finish. Which, in hindsight, we almost had an absolute finish.
An ultimate finish.
As they did a whole bunch of spots. It was a spot fest. It was not as good as many Ultimate X matches in the past. It was not bad. There was a lot of stuff going on. There were moments where it looked like sometimes people forgot what they were supposed to do. There were some spots where the people went nuts for them, but in reality... They were just a mess of a spot, and bodies were everywhere, and the fans really liked that. So, at the end, we had Daniels and Suicide climbing on top of the X-shaped structure. And they climbed through a hole, and they ended up sitting on the cables that form an X far above the ring, probably a good 12 feet. And they're sitting there, and I guess the idea was that Suicide was going to give Chris Daniels a uranage off the cables from 12 feet up. And I presume that Daniels was supposed to flip all the way over. He didn't. He fell straight down, seemingly upside down onto his head. Thought he was dead. Taz thought he was dead. The fans thought he was dead. The ref thought he was dead. The ref rushes over there, apparently realized he was not dead. So, match just continued as they laid there dead.
Acting dead.
So, they did some more spots, and finally Red got the belt and won. And the crowd was... They popped initially, but then they were very quiet again because they thought they had seen a homicide. And, to me, I don't ever want to watch a match like this again. It is now to the point after 7 years, and God bless Chris Daniels, but he's one of the prime offenders in these matches. It is now at this point, after 7 years, where they're rolling the dice with someone's life. Like, to me, it's like they are determined to continue doing this, and they're not going to stop until somebody dies. And I don't want to be watching the pay-per-view when somebody dies. I really don't. So, I don't want to ever watch a match like this again. I don't think I'm going to boycott them. But I give no rating to this match. I do not wish to speak of this match anymore on this show, and let's just move on.
I actually got angry, legit angry, at some of the stupid shit they were doing, especially with the big spot there, thinking to myself, you know, Chris Daniels has children.
Daniels has a bad neck.
And a bad neck that he has had surgery on. They would like him to come home. And not... I know this is their version of WrestleMania, but you know what? It's not WrestleMania. No one's going to... This is not going to be a legendary moment, no matter how perfect it goes. Best case scenario, you don't get hurt, and people forget about it in 2 weeks. So it's just ridiculously stupid to take these kind of risks. There's also this really dumb top rope code red spot. And the crowd went crazy for all the big stuff. And then in between, they would often just go quiet. So
let's not acknowledge this match any further.
I didn't know how to rate it either. So
let's move on, everybody.
I don't ever want to see it again.
We're going to Sarita and Taylor Wilde against the Beautiful People for the Knockout Tag Team titles. The story of the show, and this is why there were a lot of matches that I guess were good matches, but they weren't as good as maybe they seemed to be because there was so much overbooking. So referee Jamie Tucker comes out, and he was going to kick Lacey out of ringside, but she started making out with him. So he grabbed a chair and had her sit at ringside. So then out came Earl Hebner to make things right. So he's doing a babyface spot here, but of course the fans chant, "You screwed Brett." Now you would think that TNA would know enough not to have Earl Hebner play the babyface role, but of course they're not that smart. So he grabs Lacey and plants a huge kiss on her. She acts like she's all happy because she's going to get her way, but then he throws her out anyway. At which point the fans boo! So then the match continues with Jamie Tucker as the referee. It has already been established that he is biased, but they just had him referee the match. So, that was stupid. Madison was horrible. So bad that I thought they may as well just let Lacey wrestle. And Taylor made a comeback. Serena dropkicked Velvet right in the face. And then they just pinned Madison out of nowhere with the combo dropkick German. And I'm not sure whose fault it was, but Madison landed right on top of Taylor's face and appeared to have broken her nose. And at that point, I determined that someone was going to die on the show. And thankfully, nobody did. But I gave this a half star.
It did seem often like someone, like death was the goal, it almost seemed. It was a nothing match, and I mean just a nothing match, until Velva got kicked in the face. That made me laugh hard. And then Taylor got her nose busted. I didn't laugh quite as hard as that, but it was a zero-star match until that point, and then I figured, well, I'll give it one star for each injury. So I went 2 stars. That's probably way too high.
2 stars?
That's probably way too high.
2 stars means an average match. What was average about that match?
No, you're right. This was definitely below average.
I guess if you consider that every TNA match is shit, then this would be an average match. But I gave them the benefit of the doubt.
I may have been grading these on the TNA match scale, because everything on the show was better than everything you will see on most episodes of Impact. Obviously, this week, that's not true. We got a better match on Impact than anything on the show. But
Kevin Nash, Eric Young, Hernandez for the Legends title. And the story of this match was Eric Young offered Kevin Nash $60,000 to be in this match and take out Hernandez, saying it would be a win-win for everybody. Nash would retain his title. Hernandez would be taken out. So I guess a win-win for everyone except Hernandez. But they had a match. I gave it 1 star. It was not the worst thing I've ever seen, but it really wasn't all that good. And Hernandez made a big comeback. Nash was taking these horrendous bumps. Not that he could take good bumps if he wanted to at this point, but Hernandez was busted open. Young was busted open. All hard way, by the way. Cursed show. And finally, it ended up with Nash about to powerbomb Hernandez, but Eric shoved Hernandez headfirst into Nash's penis and then covered Nash for the pinfall, at which point Taz said, "Holy swerve!"
No, he didn't. I didn't catch that.
Yes, he did. "Holy swerve," he said. So Eric Young is now the king of the Legends. And as somebody asked on the board, what are the criteria for becoming the Legends champion?
Don't know.
The answer is that you pin or make the champion submit. That's it. People are reading way too much into the term Legends champion. It's just a name. I did not put these men in the match. Do not yell at me. Whatever the criteria was, it allowed Hernandez and Eric Young to get into this match. And Eric Young won, so you can't just say you don't get the championship because you're not a legend. They put him in the fucking match, so he's a legend now. There you go. I don't understand this belt, everybody.
I'm hoping when Booker leaves, he'll take it back with him.
He should.
That would be awesome. There was an actual sign in this crowd reading, "I only," and the word "only" was big and underlined, "I only came to see Kevin Nash."
Yeah.
And what this person got for only coming to see Kevin Nash was, for a large portion, in fact, large portions of the match, Kevin Nash was lying down on the apron.
Of course.
I don't know if he was selling. He appeared to just be relaxing, just chilling out. And then occasionally he would get up and drop a big, ugly elbow and then lay back down again. So that's what they got for him. And it was sloppy. It was messy. And there was one point when Hernandez ducked a clothesline and dove under the ropes for a big Undertaker dive on Eric Young. This is the first giant spot the cameraman missed of the show. It was far from the last. And I actually agree, by the end, I had this as one star. And in fact, at the end, when we saw Eric Young bleeding from the back of the head and Hernandez had his lips busted up, this is where I noted someone was going to die on the show.
Then we need TNA Tag Champs, Booker and Steiner, against IWGP Tag Champs, British Invasion, versus Beer Money, versus Steiner and Booker, in a double title ladder, tables, chairs, and chains match.
Never saw a chain.
Now, I guess I can't really yell at TNA for this, because WWE does it as well. But they can't call it a TLC match. So why a tables, ladders, chairs, and chains match? Why don't they just call it a ladder match? Why don't they just call it a hardcore match? Are you telling me that if it's a TLC match and you bring in a chain, you're going to get disqualified? What can you be disqualified for in this battle? We learned during the match you cannot be disqualified for having a man run in, which begs the question why they didn't just run in at the beginning. But all of that aside, I gave this 3 stars. It was a good match. There was some bad stuff in it, like some sloppiness, and an injury supposedly to Booker T.
Where that was not bad.
Booker T got sent outside and proceeded to begin screaming at the ref. Ref! Ref! So Charmel runs out, and a bunch of geeks run out, and Booker T begins pronouncing, and I quote, "Oh, I think I broke my back!" And, "Get me out of here, man!" And, "Ah!" All, I believe, with a smile on his face. This guy does not give a fuck. This guy was being written out of storylines and made as big a mockery out of it as possible. I presume everybody at WWE was cackling at this, because otherwise, how do you hire this man? How do you possibly hire this man?
They're not watching this show.
But you know they're going to hire him, and he's going to be the utmost professional in WWE.
Sure.
Which, really, everybody, that tells you all you need to know about TNA. So they carted him out of there. Steiner clearly either was trying to keep his job, because he's kind of been on the bubble, or they decided they want him to keep the job, and so they pushed him real hard. But he dominated everybody in this match. He belly-to-bellied everybody. He did some top-rope Frankensteiners. He did a bunch of stuff and ended up with, there was a Beer Money suplex off a ladder, which was just a complete mess. And then we had Storm giving Brutus a sunset flip powerbomb off the ladder and immediately grabbing his knee and selling it for the rest of the match. So I don't know if he got hurt or not, but wouldn't be surprised on this show. Then we had Rob Terry run in, which of course was legal, and he pressed Slam Rude over the top through a table. And only Rude's upper body hit the table, his tailbone smashed into the cement, so I'll bet he's feeling great right about now. And Doug Williams climbed up, got the TNA title belts, won those titles, they immediately cut away. And earlier, by the way, Team 3D had gotten the IWGP belt, so they won those. And if you want to see men die, this was a great match. Compared to a WWE TLC match, it was a low-rent train wreck version.
Yeah.
There you go. That's some people's cup of tea, so congratulations.
The first good portion of this match, you know, there's 8 men involved, and only one ring. So they wisely said, well, here, let's have some guys in the ring doing stuff. The rest of us will kill time just brawling on the floor. Unfortunately, nobody cued in the camera guys to this. So the camera guys follow the brawling on the floor. So we saw a lot of Scott Steiner and brawling with one or another of Team 3D. And he would, like, throw a punch and then look at the ring for a while. Then throw an elbow, and then look in the ring for a while, and we never saw the ring. This happened repeatedly. Then Booker T got the ring. They did some stuff. The crowd cheered wildly. We didn't know what, because we saw Steiner choking Devon with a cable. And then they said, oh, he did a spin-a-rooney. Great. That's wonderful. So after however many years of shooting this stuff, the director still doesn't know that the most exciting stuff is going to happen inside the wrestling ring. That is still a new revelation to him. So it was mostly a mess early, and then Steiner came in, and this is where he just started killing everyone. He threw 1,000 suplexes. He hit 1,000 clotheslines. He was busting out the top rope Frankensteiner, the top rope belly to belly. People were going crazy, and it was the best part of the show by leaps and bounds up to this point. And it was a fun little match. The British Invasion copied the Team 3D spot and made fun of it. It was pretty funny. People were in the Team 3D, and after a while, it kept going and going and going, and they started throwing in too much shit. And Rob Terry interfered, and Rhino interfered, and TN3D in particular took chair shots and did not put their hands up. They leaned into them with their heads. That annoyed me. And then finally, it just kind of ended. So it started off pretty okay, got pretty good, and then just totally tailed off by the end.
Then we had ODB, Kong, and Tara for the Knockouts title, and Tara came out wearing a tap-out shirt, which before they didn't want her to wear it, but now it makes sense. So they're doing this match, and in the middle of the match, Tara suddenly has a pull-apart with a girl in the crowd. It's Kim Couture. Flanked, by the way, by dudes in tap-out shirts. So they brawl a bit. She gets taken away. Tara leaves. Just leaves the ringside area. They stop the match. Kong's looking on like, what the fuck is this shit? And ODB is looking on, and the announcers briefly make mention of it. And then the match just starts over again, and nobody says a thing. Tara later comes back. Nobody says a thing. To pause here very briefly, what are they doing with this? Because if the idea is to build towards Tara and Kim Couture in a fake MMA battle on a TNA pay-per-view, that is going to suck a massive cock. If the idea is to build towards Tara versus Kim Couture in a pro wrestling battle, that is going to suck a massive cock. And if this is something where they're going to promote an MMA pay-per-view starring these two individuals, which I presume TNA will get very little out of, that's just stupid.
No, that would rule.
So
I can't wait for that.
I have no idea what the deal is here, but regardless, the finish of this match at least was cool in that Raisha Saeed came out and threw a chair into the ring for Kong. Kong didn't want it. She kicked it back out of the ring. Saeed threw it in again and yelled, "Use it!" Kong threw it back out again. Kong then goes to powerbomb ODB, but in mid-move, Saeed throws a chair back into the ring. ODB reverses the powerbomb into a DDT. Kong goes face-first into the chair and gets pinned. That was awesome. The rest of this sucked. I gave it 1 star.
Yeah, they were having a perfectly fine little match, except for the fact that in her intense MMA training, Tara has apparently forgotten how to run the ropes. She looked really clumsy at that. And yes, then the bullshit with Kim Couture occurred. No one had any idea what was going on. We saw, and by saw I mean Kong and ODB were in the ring, and we could see Tara in the background leaning against the guardrail. Then we saw Kong and ODB doing stuff. And then we saw Tara laying on the ground, and there was a woman there and some guys. No one told us what happened. We never saw what happened.
Because it's a shoot. They're shooting, brother.
I get your point, but we still... was there an attack? Was there physical confrontation?
Maybe Kim showed up and started yelling at her, and so Victoria or Tara went after her.
It would be cool if we knew. And I understand it was supposed to be unplanned. It would have been done if the director had cut right to them.
Well,
and
we do
the
know.
Time.
I just told you.
I see.
So now it's common knowledge, and they'll acknowledge it on Impact.
I see. Well, yes, but the crowd stopped caring about the match, and it was really lame until the finish, which was awesome.
Joe and Lashley in a submission match, which of course started with pro wrestling high spots. They did some submission stuff, and Joe was massively sick this weekend, so the guy does deserve credit for gutting this out, and he worked pretty damn hard. And this was a match where nobody gave a shit about Lashley. Well, they did, actually.
No, they hated him.
They booed very loudly, and Taz is talking about dueling chants, but the dueling chants were, "Lashley sucks, and let's go, Joe." So they did this little match here, and Lashley made a comeback, and then just put Joe in a side choke, and that was the end of the match. Now, the story, I'll explain what they're trying to do here. I gave this 2.25 stars. They're trying to get over the finish of, if a guy gets put into submission, the referee can just stop it, because the guy is in danger. They're trying to get over the fact that you don't have to tap out to lose via submission. That way they've got more potential ideas for finishes. That's what they're trying to do here. The fans didn't get it. They booed. They were angry. I actually am okay with this because if you're going to start getting things over, you've got to start somewhere. And this was as good a place as any. Hopefully they explain this on TV, because if they don't, it's never going to fucking get over. And they didn't do a good job explaining it here. Instead, the announcers were talking about it like the ref had fucked somebody over or something like that. So they could have done a significantly better job explaining this. But for what it was, I gave it 2.25 stars.
I went 2.5. Very slightly higher, really about the same. The only two things notable early were Bobby Lashley at one point did a leapfrog, and to see a guy this big jump that high just made me think, you are wasting your time here in this stupid fake sport. Just stick to real sports.
Should he be doing track and field?
Maybe. Is there a super heavyweight high jump division?
Maybe.
There should be something out there for this man to do. And also, Krystal Marshall was shown, and she is still gorgeous, so that made me happy. So, yes, then Joe beat up Lashley for a while. Crowd hated Lashley, loved Joe. So Joe hit an elbow suicida that did not make them change their minds. They did a spot where Lashley whipped Joe in and went for another leapfrog, and Joe just threw on the brakes, and Lashley landed like a fool, and Joe punched him in the ribs, and Lashley had the taped ribs, so that hurt. The crowd all laughed at Lashley like he was a geek. And Joe hit a bunch more. They traded some suplexes and stuff, and then Lashley just hooked a side choke and won. And I was fine with it just because I've seen enough MMA to know that, hey, there are ref stoppages, and I'm okay with that.
Foley and Abyss in a hardcore match. This match. Foley comes out and attacks him with a barbed wire bat as Abyss is heading down the ramp. He then proceeds to put the bat down and start doing wrestling moves on the ramp. You know what TNA needs? I was really thinking about it during this match, and I mean, it's been mentioned before, but I don't think people realize how important this is. TNA needs to raid like Pat Patterson. Or somebody that can actually put matches together that make sense. Because these matches piss me off so bad. I don't know if the wrestlers put it together themselves and they're not sure what the hell they're doing. And I realize Mick fucking Foley's in this match. Or if Terry Taylor puts them together and he doesn't fucking know what he's doing. But you're doing a hardcore match. The very first spot is you attack somebody with a barbed wire baseball bat. And then you put the bat down and go up to the ramp and start doing wrestling maneuvers. Why would you do that? So then, Foley immediately just starts climbing a scaffold. Why? I have no idea. So he climbs the scaffold, Abyss goes after him, Foley punches him a few times in the head, Abyss takes a bump off the scaffold, crashes through the stage into a gigantic heap. This is 2 minutes into the match. Then Foley just goes down back to the ring again. Or first he gets the bat and he does a running barbed wire-assisted flying elbow onto Abyss in the hole. Meanwhile, the fans are chanting for Foley, who is supposed to be the heel. So, we go back to the ring, start doing wrestling. Abyss does a comeback. Sets up a barbed wire board, made of real barbed wire, by the way, between the apron and the guardrail. Back in the ring, we get some more stuff. There's a DDT onto the barbed wire. Abyss gigs. He's bleeding all over. Then he gets sent face first into another one and then pushed over onto another board, and so he's sandwiched in between them. This is all real barbed wire, by the way, because there are hairs sticking to it and stuff. And then Foley spreads the thumbtacks all over the mat, and Abyss goes to chokeslam him into him, but Stevie says, no, you can't do that or you'll be DQ'd. Because you see, Foley announced that only he could use thumbtacks. Okay. Too fucking complicated, but fine. So Foley ends up, I'm sorry, Abyss beats up Stevie. Daphne runs down, gives Foley the taser after the ref bump. Because you see, in a hardcore Monsters Ball match, presumably the taser would have been a DQ. I guess. I don't know. I don't know why you use a fucking taser in a match like this. So, Foley tasers Abyss in the stomach, and this results in Abyss's stomach exploding in sparks and flame. All right.
The taser is powerful, let me tell
you. As I've said before, when I do these reviews now, instead of saying why, now I just say, why not? Why not use a taser on the stomach and the guy's abdominal area explodes in flame? Abyss falls down and Foley makes the cover. They send another ref in and the ref counts 1, 2, 3. Abyss then kicks out. The ref says, the match continues. Everybody in the crowd goes, what the fuck? Match keeps going. Even the announcers are like, that was a 3 count. Taz is like, I'm not being sarcastic. Sure was. Do they explain it? No. Match just keeps fucking going. So the match keeps going, and the ref goes to count after Foley is sent into barbed wire. Stevie pulls the ref out of the ring and punches him. Daphne tries to climb the ropes, and then Abyss proceeds to chokeslam her onto the barbed wire board set up between the guardrail and the ring apron. She crashes through the barbed wire board. Of course, the director misses this. On the biggest show of the year, I ask the question. We used to joke about this about Don West. Has anyone smartened Don up yet? Does Don know that this is fake? Has anybody smartened up the fucking director? Does anybody ever go to the director and go, listen, Keith, at the end of this match here, the chick's going to go through the barbed wire board, so can you make sure that we get a good shot of it? Apparently not. She goes through this goddamn barbed wire board, which, do we really need to see the girl go through the board? But everybody cheers. Everybody goes nuts, because of course these are... I'm just going to move on. So, Stevie...
Taz called them sick.
Stevie then proceeds to take off his shirt. Of course! Because he's right by Tax! So he gets tossed into the Tax. Abyss then gives Foley a slam onto the board, the barbed wire board. And that's the pin. Because Stevie gets dragged over unconscious, and Abyss takes Stevie's unconscious hand and counts three for the pin. All of which we saw in the mid-90s in WWE. Of course. That was the end of the match. So I like how, at the end of the match, the finish is a slam on a board. After all of this other bullshit.
Barbed wire.
This was an amateur hour mess of bullshit. Thumbs down.
Okay, here's the only justification I have for why I like this a little bit more than you. Abyss had a lot of enemies coming into this match. Dr. Steve, you've been trying to kill him for months. Foley had turned on and broken his heart, and Daphne was there to help both of them try to screw him over. And by the end of this, he had defeated them all. This actually, was one of the, we talked about how this does not feel like a WrestleMania show. This seemed like the end of a story here on what was allegedly the biggest show of the year.
Well, I'll take your word for that one.
That's my opinion. Now,
we'll find out on Thursday.
If we figure out on Thursday, and Foley has booked himself and Stevie versus Abyss in a handicap match, I will retract my approval of this match. There's a lot of stupid stuff. The crowd did seem to like it, so I just talked about them earlier. But they gave the crowd what they wanted, and like I say, by the end, they appeared to have actually wrapped up storylines, which never happens in this company. So, was it really that good? No. Have I seen better? Yes. Do I want to see men and women going through barbed wire and mutilating themselves? No, although with Abyss by this point, I'm just completely numb to it. He's done so much worse to himself. And then, by the end, there was an end of the story. We can close that book. So, a temporary thumbs up.
I guess I shouldn't make fun of them too much because our website does this often, but I tried to go to TNAwrestling.com and it's just crashed. Now, they did lose, they did invest $30 million into this, which we did not. You'd never see WWE's website go down on WrestleMania Sunday. So, TNA, get your goddamn shit in order here.
Well, why would a rinky-dink company like this do that?
And we had Kurt Angle and Matt Morgan. This was where the show turned around. I gave this 3.25 stars. They tried really hard. It wasn't... To be honest, it really wasn't much until about the last 5 minutes or so, at which point it got really good. But they told the story of Matt Morgan wrestled the best match of his career. Angle kicked out of everything. Morgan kicked out of everything. They did a bunch of spots, near falls, reversals at the end. And finally, Angle went up for the moonsault. Morgan went underneath him. Angle turned into a victory roll for the clean pin. And it was a good finish. It was a great finish, actually. And it was very much like, not as good a match by far, but I'll never forget the match that Edge and Kurt Angle had at like a Backlash or something like that. And this was like a turning point match for Edge, where in the middle of the match that people really didn't care all that much about, Edge got a near fall off a top rope drop kick, and the people got into it like it was one of the best matches they ever saw. They had a shitload of great near falls and this and that, and finally Angle beat him clean, and it was like this incredibly close, hard-fought battle where Edge took it to the limit with this guy. He lost by the skin of his teeth, and he got over maybe even bigger than if he would have won. I love that match, and this was what they tried to do here, and in the end, Matt Morgan is not Edge, okay? He had a really good match, but this was still 3.25. Matt Morgan is very limited. And they do what they can with him, but he's still a limited performer, both in promos and in the ring. But they did the best with what they could, and I give this match a thumbs up. And then afterwards, Angle took him into the ring, offered him to shake his hand. Morgan shook his hand. Angle walked away. No Angle, nothing. And at that point, I thought for sure that AJ was turning heel in the main event, but that did not happen.
It was kind of funny because, as you know, the first half of this match was just nothing. No one cared at all. Kurt kicked out of a choke slam. Nobody cared. Morgan kicked out of an angle slam. Nobody cared. Then there was a point where the camera cut to absolutely, literally nothing. There was just a close-up of across the arena. Just some dead space for a while. And then Angle hooked the ankle lock, and Morgan fought and fought, and after a minute or so of that, he got out. Then they started doing all the big moves, and suddenly the crowd got into it, and it was like they knew this match is not ending until Kurt Angle hooks the ankle lock. So they didn't buy any near falls before that, but once it was applied, then they were in everything, and it was quite awesome from that point on. The last 3 or 4 minutes were really damn great. So I went 3.5, liked a little more than you. I also like that Angle won clean, but at the same time, Morgan kicked out at 3.1. So he was beaten, but he was not destroyed, humiliated, leveled. He was not the better man on this day. But were they to meet again, he may be triumphant.
I got the TNA website to work, and sadly there's not a preview for Thursday's show yet. So if I get the preview before we go off the air here, I will in fact announce what we've got on tap for Thursday's show. All right. Oh, how about that? Dave's got somewhat of an update. The woman who attacked Tara was Kim Couture. They are trying to play it off as a shoot, but it was an angle that likely nobody was told about beforehand.
Woo!
Awesome.
That explains a lot, doesn't it?
All right. Let's see where we are.
AJ and Sting.
I just got an email. I had to check here real very quickly.
Might read it out loud.
AJ versus Sting. I give this 3 stars. It was a solid wrestling match. Sting is now 50 years old. They did all they could. There were long stretches where the fans weren't really into it. I cannot fault the wrestling really at all. It was a strong performance by both guys. The finish, they did a bunch of spots, and then AJ hit a Pele kick on the apron, and Sting didn't take a bump, and then he kind of stood in the middle of the ring, and then he just kind of did a back bump. And then AJ did a springboard splash, and the ref counted the pin.
And the ref
counted
over.
The pin. And I thought, huh, what? Came completely out of nowhere. No build to the finish. But I don't know. I guess in a sense it was, I'm stretching here, but it's always good to every now and then have a match where the finish comes out of nowhere so people start buying near falls later on. I'll just pretend that's what this was all about. But also they were running completely out of time, so they had to go to the finish very, very quickly. So after the match, they got Sting into the ring, and AJ grabbed the mic and told him to come back. It was his time. And he left, and Sting got the mic and was trying to do a promo, and the people chanted, "Please don't go," and "You still got it," and "Thank you, Sting," and "One more year." And he said he wasn't pulling a Brett Favre, but he just was not prepared to make an announcement tonight. And he said this was not kayfabe, but that he didn't know if he was going to come back. And he said, "Last night, some of the people said to him at fanfare made him want to stay forever." And as soon as he said the word forever, they cut his mic and played his music, and the show went off the air. It's TNA, everybody. It's never going to be perfect. And I presume Sting is coming back to do the farewell tour into early 2010, but I don't think he's going to be back for the next year. But you never know. He was happy at the FanFest. So 3 stars. AJ's being much more careful in how he works his matches. There was no heel turn. He's taking a lot less risks. And like I said, it was good for what it was and what they had.
The best part of this match, and perhaps of the entire show, was the pre-match graphic in which AJ Styles was listed as being 6 feet tall. Oh, how I laughed. I laughed hard. They had a fun match. The crowd, they appreciated it, but it's not like they really cared who won, because both guys are baby faces, so they just kind of cheered whenever there was a cool move and sort of got into it. And then they did chant, "This is wrestling," at one point. And then, as noted, AJ's hit the Pele on the apron, which was stupid, because it involved him landing on his head and shoulder on the apron. Then he hit the springboard and won. And it was sudden, an abrupt ending to this. And then things got really good again. We've mocked their direction, we've mocked their website, and it's time to mock their audio equipment, because TNA is a rinky-dink company.
Oh, I forgot about this.
And AJ started to cut his promo, and he was interrupted by the microphone producing a long series of whines and whistles and pops and groans and other terrible, terrible feedback. So he gave up on that one. They gave him a second microphone. He made no noise whatsoever. The crowd booed him tremendously. They gave him a third microphone, and he was finally able to cut his promo.
I believe his exact words, "Can you hear me now?
Can you finally hear me?" or something, yes. And then he cut his promo. He told Sting. He called Sting back down to the ring. Sting looked confused. AJ said, "Sting, this is your time." And Sting had a look on his face like, "My time to do what?" And then he got into the ring and he cut his promo about how he doesn't know he's coming back, but he liked being at home, and he liked, if he's going to lose, it should be to a guy like AJ at home. And he finally left, and they played his music, and he started shaking hands with fans, many of whom were dressed like him. And then Mike Tenay said, "This is a special night and a very special moment." Then it ended.
Yeah.
Did not feel special.
Yeah, I mean, it's. I guess you have to do this because this is kind of your job, but throughout the show, I mean, the theme of this show was them telling us, without using these exact words, but them telling us this is TNA's WrestleMania. Over and over again, we were told how big Bound for Glory was. And in the end, it was just another TNA pay-per-view.
It was the TNA pay-per-view for the month of October.
As it is every year.
Yes.
And what can you say?
I don't know. And the people that there were points in the main event where like they had a long battle over the Scorpion Death Drop, which they both used, and Sting finally got it, and people like leapt to their feet and pumped their fists. So
yeah.
Clearly they were doing something right.
Yeah.
But was it? You know, did it feel like the biggest show of the year? No.
To the back.
All right, we're gonna do Impact here, and I think it was Crumbly who said after reading the spoilers that this is gonna be like the best. The best several weeks of best several weeks of Impact in a long time, because the debut of Nigel and all of this other stuff. And I just got to say that when I read the spoilers, I expected this to be a really exciting 2 weeks. And let's just say that my imagination running wild reading the spoilers was so much better than this fucking show. Not the worst Impact I've ever seen. We say this every week, and I should stop saying that. I'll just let you know when it is the worst Impact I've ever seen. But this place has got some problems. This place has got some fucking problems.
Did you get this out?
What?
That it has problems?
Should we get it out?
You figured this out?
Oh, so should we get this out?
No.
I'm trying to get it out every week. I've been doing it for 7 years now. So Angle came out. Tons of boos. And cuts a promo about how it was 1 year ago that he formed the Main Event Mafia. Now he stood there without a family. Started talking about the Mafia was never about securing spots in the company because he knew since day one that he was always going to be the best. He said it wasn't about job security because he knew he was better than everyone else. He said it was about respect, respect for the wrestlers, respect for the game. They were in it because they loved it. They weren't in it for the money or the ego. They were in it for pride. I could have sworn, by the way, that many times they said it was all about the money. Maybe that was just Kevin Nash.
I'm pretty sure when Sting got kicked out, they all declared it's been about money the entire time or something. But
anyway, so at the beginning, you saw a bunch of snot-nosed punks, but now those punks were boys turning into men, and he put over AJ and Morgan, the latter of whom he said reminded him of himself 10 years ago. He does not remind me of Kurt Angle 10 years ago.
I think this may be even more absurd, actually, but I think he was talking about Eric Young there.
Even worse.
That is actually worse.
Anyway, he told everyone in the back that they had nothing to prove to him. He now considered them his peers. He may as well have said, "I'm a babyface now."
Isn't it amazing how wrestling AJ, I guess wrestling AJ, and then wrestling Morgan has changed his mind 180 degrees?
Yeah.
Magic.
So Rhino came out and said he couldn't believe all of this. He said the Mafia was gone, Booker was gone, Angle couldn't fight this fight alone. At which point I began asking various questions such as, why is the Mafia done? Did I miss a show? What happened?
Nothing.
Okay.
They were a unit when the pay-per-view ended. And apparently on the drive home or the after party, they broke up.
Okay. So then Rhino's talking about how TNA management wanted guys like him and Angle gone, to which I thought, they do? Since when? I was completely unaware of this storyline. So Rhino said none of these young punks had learned a thing, and then Team 3D came out, and security had to hold them back. They were talking about Rhino interfering at Bound for Glory. which I'd completely forgotten about. I guess, was he the one that laid him out with chair shots?
Yes.
I presume that's what happened.
Yeah.
So anyway, Rhino said that he had to do what he had to do, and Bubba called him paranoid and grabbed a chair, and security held him back, and Rhino kept talking about how TNA wanted to get rid of him, but he wasn't leaving until he'd breathed his last breath. So, to conclude, I don't know what's going on.
No, I had no idea what the point of this was. I assume... I don't think any of these men are feuding with Kurt, so he just happened to be there. It appears they're going to do a feud with 3D and Rhino, although at some point Rhino would need a tag team partner for this, I would think. If I was in charge, I would give him one. It went for a long time. There was a lot of passion involved, a lot of anger. I didn't really know what was happening, and then it ended.
Yeah. By the way, I don't think on this entire show we saw Mick Foley or Sting.
No, I believe you're right.
Oh, really? I don't know if there was any mention made, except for maybe like in the first video package. So then Lauren's backstage interviewing AJ and Daniels about what Kurt had just said. And AJ said, if Kurt was telling the truth, that was a huge step for TNA. He said this wasn't about him and Kurt. This was about all of them against the competition. The competition, you say? I presume that means WWE.
Sure said New York.
I thought that ship sailed on day one, actually. So then Lauren, out of nowhere, starts talking about AJ and Daniels and Joe in a three-way at the pay-per-view. This was the first mention of the main event on the next show. Lauren offhandedly remarking about it in an interview segment. It's just like, what happens here?
Well, I don't know.
They need somebody to read the script that doesn't know what's going on and ask these questions every week. Like, I think they've got all these ideas and these plans, and so they don't bother setting any of them up. They're just, once they have an idea in their heads, that's just the way things are. And the audience should just accept it as the way things
are. It is known to everyone except the audience.
Yeah. That was something else.
It was a secret main event. I just like that they announced this match, and my first thought was, wait a minute, Joe lost clean at the pay-per-view. Now he's getting a world championship match? And I thought that was stupid, but maybe...
And Daniels was almost killed.
Maybe no one knows. And then Daniels pointed out, Joe, you had a tough loss at the pay-per-view, and I was almost killed. What the hell?
They needed a match. So then they plugged tonight's match, which was the three of them, AJ, Daniels, and Joe, in a tag match. AJ and Daniels versus Joe and Kevin Nash.
Sure.
Why not?
Why not? Why not?
Lauren then interviewed Raisha about her match with Kong tonight. Yes, tonight. Sunday was their breakup after years of teaming together. 2 years they teamed together. Raisha screwed up on Sunday. Now they're having a blow-off match.
Yes.
On TV.
Yes. Hmm. And then they cut to Mike Tenay, who said a wedge had been driven between them by, and I quote, recent issues. It was one match.
Yeah.
Remember 2 days ago we were talking about how great the Shawn Michaels and Marty Jannetty breakup was?
Yeah.
This is the opposite of that.
Yeah. So he had Homicide versus Red, and Homicide attacked him in the entranceway and beat him all the way to the ring. And by the way, I just want to throw in a reminder that last week's show, the go-home show for Bound for Glory, did an 0.9 rating. So if you're wondering why on this show we've got all of this nuttiness, a cage match and an Ultimate X match all on free TV, plus Kong versus Saeed in a blow-off match, now you know. Someone's freaking out about his numbers dropping. So Don West is there at ringside, and Red made a comeback and hit the infrared. Homicide kicked out. Taz totally marked out. And
it was a very cool spot.
It was. Homicide then gave a sidewalk slam and hit a gringo killer for the pin. So way to go, Don. Way to go.
Just turn things around.
They did mention offhandedly that this was a non-title match.
Yeah, I did not know that until they brought it up after the fact. I would not complain because this was a short match, but it was really, really fun.
It was fun. Yeah.
I had a fun TV match. I was entertained, so it gets a win.
So Lauren interviews Steiner about how the Mafia was finished, and Steiner's like, what the fuck are you talking about? Which is a great question. And he said Angle didn't speak for him. He wasn't giving these punks any credit. Said he was going to start with Mike Morgan tonight. And she said his name was Matt. And Steiner says, Matt, Mike, I'll beat them both up. Comedy, everybody.
It was comedy in that this is another promo where Steiner's gimmick is that he does not watch the show.
Mm-hmm.
It was news to him the Main Event Mafia had broken up. He said, I am still wearing Main Event Mafia gear. I just left the Main Event Mafia locker room, which I believe, by the way. And he did not know Morgan's first name.
Yeah.
Awesome.
So they had the match, and Krystal Lashley's at ringside. Steiner gives her the eye before the match, and so they go in there and they wrestle. And Morgan, who is 7 feet tall, is playing the babyface in peril. That's comedy. Morgan makes a comeback. Steiner cuts him off. And then he goes to ringside and starts pawing all over Krystal. So, of course, Bobby runs out to make the save. They brawled at ringside, which is not a DQ. They get up on the apron. They get up on the apron, and Bobby Lashley punches Scott Steiner right in the face, right in front of the ref. And the ref doesn't call for a DQ. And by the way, this is important based on stuff that happens later in the show. So he punches him right in the face. Steiner gets pinned. So Steiner loses to set up Steiner versus Lashley.
Mm-hmm.
Why Steiner couldn't just come out and kill Puma, I have no idea. To set up a match with Lashley.
Well, I don't know.
This was a mess.
I just like that. And again, this is more of what we're just talking about here, but Scott Steiner went from not caring about Bobby Lashley at all to harassing his wife to feuding with him in one segment.
Mm-hmm.
They've done this before many times in wrestling. I mean, I'm thinking of Jake Roberts and Rick Rude here. But I believe Rude pursued Cheryl Roberts for like 2 months. And then before there was finally any kind of physical contact. And then he did what Steiner did here. He grabbed his hands and rubbed them all over his own chest. And then the husband ran out and kicked his ass. A great idea in theory. The execution here sucked.
Shocking.
Yeah.
So the Lashleys do a promo backstage, and Bobby said Scott had better apologize or he'd be in trouble, and which way they immediately cut away. Like, immediate. Then we had Joe and Nash against AJ and Daniels. Joe came out not even wearing his face paint this evening. He doesn't care no more. So they had a really good match until Nash tagged in. Why is he in this match, you ask? Well, the answer is because he had to pin Chris Daniels. The main event of the pay-per-view is Daniels versus AJ versus Joe for the world title. And Kevin Nash pinned Daniels in this match.
The one man not in the main event of the pay-per-view got the win.
This business has so passed me by.
Clearly. I do not understand either anymore what's going on.
So apparently this was done because Nash yelled at Eric Young and said he was going to come get him to get his $60,000 back. So it was more important to put over Kevin Nash versus Eric Young for the Legends title than your fucking three-way world title main event rematch of the best match in company history.
Well, they're stupid.
Yes.
I will, in their defense, they did talk about the finish, the Joe versus Lashley match, the ref stoppage finish. Taz was talking about this and said it was a good finish, and Joe had told him he was happy the ref stepped in and saved him. It was a wise decision by the referee, so there was not another ref stoppage on the show. But at least they're trying to point out that the ref stoppage is a valid finish to a match.
So, Lauren interviewed the Guns about the... I'm missing something here. Eric Young did a promo, and he basically said next week he had an earth-shattering announcement that was going to shake TNA to its foundations.
Yes, he also told Nash, I am not hard to find, but then by the end of the show, Nash had not found him.
Yeah.
So, that was a lie.
Lauren interviewed the Guns about Ultimate X, and it is a number one contender Ultimate X tag team match, apparently to set up a straight match for the pay-per-view.
Yeah.
Of course. Why not?
For free with no bill.
Why not? Beautiful People hijacked a camera, shot their newest feature, Meanest Girls. They found Sarita and Taylor and beat them up in catering with food all over themselves. It was a mess. And for some odd reason, in the middle of this 30-second segment, they had to do an edit.
There are actually two edits here. So apparently this originally went like 40 seconds, and they had to cut it down to 30. All I can say about this is it was the worst possible television involving Velvet Sky and tight jeans and a bra.
Kong killed Saeed, and they had a surprisingly lackluster match. I thought this match was going to be great, and instead it was very average. And Saeed hit a super fame asser, then Kong got her knees up on a splash, gave her an earthquake splash, implant buster for the pin. And then today's like, Kong got a revenge. And I was like, first off,
yes.
How do you get revenge for an accident? I guess it's possible, but that's mean. It was an accident. And she got her revenge for what happened on Sunday.
Yes. I just like, they went from partners to feuding to feud settled in two segments.
Yes.
Amazing.
So then Kong took her up to the ramp and gave her a power bomb off the ramp onto, quote, an area, as TNA described it. And that was the end of Raisha Saeed. After 2 years, They never unmasked her as cheerleader Melissa or as Alyssa Flash. They never did a mask versus hair match. They never did a mask versus mask match. They just wrote off the character.
I was just terrified because from the camera angle, it looked like Raisha was going actually off the ramp to the floor, and I thought there'd be a fatality. So then she went through a board and padded thing, and I thought, oh, thank God. So, yeah, it is amazing what this company does not do.
Rhino and Hernandez. Hernandez did his wacky dive. He's going to kill himself someday.
Yeah, he did the big Undertaker dive, which is called the Undertaker dive because the Undertaker busts it out once a year.
Yes, he does it in every match.
Hernandez is doing it every match.
So Team 3D comes out to do commentary, and Taz is trying to calm them down, saying, listen, I know you guys want to kill Rhino, but we've known him forever. He's a combustible fellow, this and that. So, of course, Rhino loses the match, and afterwards he immediately attacks Hernandez, and he's beating on him, and they get in another brawl, and Hernandez cuts him off and goes for the border toss. But as he's about to give Rhino the border toss, Team 3D jumps in the ring and says, no, 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 no. And so he lets Rhino go, and Rhino runs away, leaving me gobsmacked at why Team 3D just saved the guy that they were talking for the entire show about how they wanted to kill.
Mm-hmm. Bubba was sitting there with his head wrapped saying, you gave me this latest concussion. How dare you? What's wrong with you? Blah, 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 blah.
I swear to God I'm going to get you, he said.
The show opened with the two men coming out, apparently willing to fight him 2-on-1.
Yeah.
And yet now when another man was going to hurt him, they stopped him and let him go free.
Yeah.
Doesn't make any sense.
No.
And I will also say...
it does not at all.
It does not make any sense at all. I will also say that on commentary, Bubba blamed Rhino for the latest chair shot. Bubba blamed Rhino for his latest concussion. That's your fault, dude. Get your hands up.
Yeah.
That is your fault.
Then Angle did a promo backstage, putting over all the young guys and wishing AJ luck in a three-way and saying he was going to get his title shot the month after. Write that down, everybody. In walked Nigel McGuinness. Desmond Wolfe, he said his name was. Said he was a huge fan of Kurt, had followed Angle's career since the Olympics. Angle was the reason he was a pro wrestler. So Angle shook his hand, and Nigel turned around and got an evil look on his face and then turned and beat the piss out of Kurt. And all I got to say is, reading about this segment in the spoilers, again, what I imagined in my head was so much cooler than this, how it has actually played out on television. It was a very lackluster debut, really.
Yeah, well,
it just...
There have been worse,
don't get me wrong, but I mean, it was like...
This
lacked impact here on Impact.
I think this may be... Maybe this is a minor detail, but the fact that this happened backstage...
In a random time.
Yeah, if this had opened the show in the ring with the crowd going nuts, and if you give, it's going to take some time getting used to this, if you give Desmond a big entrance with music and lights, then he comes out, that's something special. This is just some guy jumping Kurt from behind. And also, who decided to shave Nigel's head?
He's actually been shaved for a long, long time.
Oh, I didn't know that. I've not seen that recently. Yeah. All right, well.
It's been shaved probably 5 or 6 months now, actually.
I see. I don't like it. He needs the spiky head back.
He looks too much like a normal guy right now.
He does. He looks plain.
Lethal and Creed against the Motor City Machine Guns Ultimate X, number one contenders tag team match. By the way, the cage match originally went on before this. This was the main event of the show originally, but they switched it around. So this went on, the cage match got moved to the main event position. But anyway, they had 8 minutes, I believe. I actually haven't written down the exact amount of time that they have. What is it? Anyway, they did the best they could with the 7 minutes or so that they had and did all sorts of spots and that sort of thing. And Sabin scaled the cables, got the X for the win. And I guess the only thing that I really need to say about this, besides that it was really fun... Oh, it was 7 minutes long. The only thing I really have to say about this is I strongly disagree with the Machine Guns and the fact that I thought their old music was so much better than their new music, because their old music sounded like it was straight out of a New Japan show, which is kind of their gimmick. They're the young high flyers that go and work internationally, so it fit them. Their new music sounds like every other goofy song that they make for people in TNA.
Okay. I enjoyed this match specifically because, unlike the Ultimate X we saw Sunday where someone nearly died, in this match, they teased a bunch of really, really, really scary things and then delivered on almost none of them. they would have set up for some kind of super Tower of Doom spot that started with Jay Lethal on top of the pile, hanging upside down from the cables, and if they'd actually tried to pull this off, he would have died for sure. And then guys just sort of jumped down, and Lethal was still on the ropes, he kept on climbing, and they pulled him down later. Guys got pulled off the ropes and landed on their feet. There was an actually brilliant spot early on where the machine guns teased a double tope, and the last second, Sabin is kind of vaulted over the ropes and played interference, keeping the other wrestlers at bay as Shelley launched himself back in the ring and made him climb the ropes to get the X. I thought that spot ruled because they wanted to win the match more than kill someone. That's good. So they did a bunch of other stuff. I don't even remember anything in this match particularly terrifying. And then the machine guns won, and it was fun. So this gets a thumbs up.
We had some interviews with British Invasion and Beer Money, which were very good. British Invasion was talking about how they won the titles at the pay-per-view, which proved they were the best team in the company, which is a true statement. And they said, all Americans care about is alcohol and money. And tonight they were going to make Beer Money poor and sober.
That was tremendous. Tremendous dialogue.
And then Beer Money did a promo and talked about how British Invasion was foolish for agreeing to this match. It was a cage match, nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. So they have the match. This fucking company sometimes. They have a tag team cage match.
Yeah.
So the heels isolate Rude. Because you see, Storm is standing on the apron. And he won't get in the ring without a tag. And I'm thinking, it's a cage match. What are they going to fucking do? Disqualify you if you get in the ring without a legal tag? So I'm thinking about this, and meanwhile they're having a match. And, of course, finally, as soon as they make a hot tag to Storm, then it's just like a four-way. And everybody's in the ring at the same time. They're all beating on each other. It's not a DQ, which makes me even more angry at the idiocy of this. They do a stacked-up stupidplex spot, which was even stupider than usual. And
this was horrifying.
The only way it could have been botched worse is if somebody died. That's how fucked up this was. And again, I said this on Sunday. I'm so sick of TNA putting all these guys in positions to get hurt really bad. And every time they make it out okay, but you roll the dice every time. And it's a matter of odds. You do this like Hernandez. Okay. What are the odds if I fly to Vegas tomorrow I'm going to get in a plane crash?
Low.
Very low. What are the odds I'll get in a plane crash if I fly to Vegas every day for the rest of my life?
Higher.
So if you're the Undertaker and you do your goofy dive over the top ropes once a year, you know, at some point as you get older, you should probably stop doing it. But
that's just being past that point.
You've got a 1 in 365 chance that you're going to screw it up and die.
Your math is questionable, but I see your point.
Well,
if you do it every day, it's a 365 chance of 365 chance, or something like that.
Anyway, the point is,
the more you do it, the more likely you are to die.
That's right. You have 365 out of 365% chance. Anyway, fuck it, everyone. The point is, like, if you do it every day, you have more of a chance of dying.
Yeah.
Which Hernandez is doing. Okay, when you put these guys in a position to do stupid shit on every show, and look at how many people got hurt at the last pay-per-view, and Daniels almost legitimately got killed. Did that make them change anything they did here? No. Oh, hey, guys, do a four-man stacked-up superplex spot off the top of the fucking cage and all fall on each other and land on your head and shit like that, and hopefully you're all okay. So, fuck this company. I don't want to see somebody die, and it's getting to the point now where I'm thinking something's going to happen. I mean, it's just inevitable. Someone's
going to... It seems that way.
Actually, Sabin did. Sabin got hurt the next night. Anyway,
there was a point here... In this stacked-up stupidplex, Doug Williams was on top of the pile, upside down, and hanging free for a moment. He was not attached to the cage. He was just out there, four human beings high, upside down. And then he dropped and did not go out at an angle, dropped more or less straight down.
Yeah.
And thank God he rotated over and landed on his back. But
just stop this shit.
Yeah.
Just stop.
No one cares. You're not making any money off it. Your ratings aren't going up.
They're going down.
Stupid show.
They're going down, so you're putting even more people's lives in danger.
And I put some of the blame for this, by the way, on the Doug Williams of the world and Chris Daniels for putting himself in a position to be upside down on the cables.
There is that.
Everyone in this company, stop doing this shit.
There is something. As much as people still talk about how there are problems with the wellness policy in WWE, which, in fact, there are still some problems. It's not perfect. But that company is legitimately going out of its way to try to tone down the product and stop people from doing stupid shit. And TNA does not give a fuck about the health of its performers. We've seen that in a million different ways on this show alone. And Kevin Nash flipped out about it. I'm sure most of you heard the story by now, but when Sabin got hurt, Nash actually came to the ring and cut a promo on the company for not stopping the match when Sabin was down injured in the ring. So, Jesus Christ, people, stop.
I hope so, that part airs.
Then it gets worse. As I'm thinking about, well, what happens if all four guys get in the ring? They're doing this match, and Brutus punches the ref. And they send a bunch of refs into the ring, and the refs proceed to disqualify the British Invasion in a cage match. A DQ in a cage match. How can people defend this show?
I don't know.
I mean, seriously.
I don't know. I think it's amazing. And actually,
I look back at Tom V today, bitching at me, and I'm like, how do you defend this show?
It's been a long time since we said this, to be fair. But we always, there was a period, it's been about 6 months, maybe more, but there was a period where each impact was worse than the week before. And it was a new, stupidest thing we'd ever seen. We have not said that in a while. This was the new, stupidest thing I've ever seen. Every time we think they've bottomed out, they get deeper.
Yeah.
A DQ in a cage match. And in fact, it's worse. Because Mike Tenay explained that the British Invasion had agreed to this cage match because TNA had come to them and said, we need ratings. And so the British Invasion said, okay, but only if this is Beer Money's last title shot.
Wow.
So it was Beer Money's last title shot inside a steel cage for free with no build. And then the British just got disqualified. So the British Invasion's plan was to get disqualified in the steel cage match. That was the goal going in.
Mm-hmm. Thank God they got that one worked out.
And men nearly died. I don't even know.
Let's move on.
Yes.
In about 90 seconds, we had four segments take place. First, we had Angle heading to the ring in his gear, looking all angry because he had a score to settle with Nigel McGuinness. Then they cut backstage, and Lauren was interviewing AJ. She wanted to know if there were problems with him and Daniels tonight. I do not recall this, but Lauren did. So he denied it. And she said it looked like a misunderstanding, and he denied it. And as he's about to leave, a mystery bald man attacks him and beats him up. And this beating was about a half a second long, and they cut away. They go back to the announcers. The announcers are like, did you see who that bald man was? No, who was it? I don't know. They then cut to an announcement that next week it's Abyss versus Dr. Stevie and Daphne in a handicap match.
I retract my endorsement.
Thank you, Vinny.
Of the Monsters Ball match.
You were, in fact, wrong.
At the pay-per-view.
Yeah. So, great job with that one. And then they immediately, after 1 second, cut back to Angle in the ring, calling out Nigel. This is all, I swear to God, within a 90-second period. So, Nigel runs out and attacks Angle, lays him out, gives him the Tower of London, brings a chair into the ring to finish the job, and then says it would be too easy to do it this way. He wants Angle to think about it for a while, and he concludes, by the way, my name is Wolfe. Desmond Wolfe. And the show ended. Huh. It seemed a hell of a lot better reading those spoilers.
Yeah.
In execution, fail yeah, this program.
Somewhere between the drawing board and the battlefield, something went awry. And it did not work out. I mean, again, I have seen worse debuts. He did walk out triumphant, leaving Kurt Angle laying in a heap. That's good. But it should have been better.
You know, another thing Tom brought up. He was upset that I had made the comment that it's TNA, it doesn't matter. He thought that they deserved better.
He was false. He was incorrect.
Listen, this Desmond Wolfe, Kurt Angle thing, people are going to go on the board and say, why is Bryan so harsh about this? At least they're debuting a new guy at the top. At least they're putting a new guy over. They're trying to push a new star. And actually, hey, I thought that before I watched this show. I said those exact same things. I was like, hey, I'm happy at least they're Nigel's debuting. He's being pushed right to the top. Sounded great. I watched it on TV, and it's like, What was the last big debut? Lashley? A lot of fucking good that did. They sure did a hell of a lot with him. I see 5 weeks down the road, Nigel is just another guy on the show.
Probably feuding with Morgan or Nash.
Or who would he be feuding with? I'm trying to think here. I was going to say someone like Eric Young, but he's also a heel. But yeah, in 5 weeks, Nigel's going to be just another guy because it is TNA, and it doesn't matter. Yeah. This is just the way it's always been, and it is not going to change. And that is not my fault. It's really not.
No. I will say that when I first heard Nigel was coming here and not WWE, I was bummed for him because I actually thought he would have a better shot at going to ECW and being someone, or SmackDown and being someone, and then coming on this show and being someone. I figured he'd be...
I actually thought he had a better chance on Impact.
Well, maybe...
I don't know.
I don't know if you're right or wrong.
I don't know. We'll see.
I expected him, when I heard he was going to TNA, I thought he would just be, honestly, another X Division guy. He would be a new, larger English Sanjay Dutt.
Mm.
And instead, they put him in there with Angle, and at the end of the show, he left him laying. So it is better than I anticipated.
Well, I guess. I knew this was going to... I mean, I knew he was going right into a feud with Angle. But just, like I said, reading it, it sounded so much better in the spoilers.
It sounds better than it really looked, yes.
Yeah, I had all sorts of great ideas in my head and how it would look and execution. And then I saw it, and it was like, oh, that's it? It's everything else I always see on Nitro or Impact. It's exactly what we see every week with just a different guy. So, I don't know, everybody. We'll see. But I thought this was a bad Impact. This was a poor television show. And I guess we'll see what they do next week. They're going to build up the Angle Nigel thing much stronger next week, so we'll see how it goes.
I had enough good wrestling on the show to go at least a thumbs in the middle.
Hmm. You were much more generous than I was for once. To the back! I have got some stuff to say about Impact. If you're a fan of Impact, I'm just going to tell you right now, just turn this show off. Just turn this show off because you're not going to like what I have to say. I hate Impact. I hate Impact. I hate this show so fucking much that, as God is my witness, if Hulk Hogan coming to TNA and booking himself as the champion and beating everybody, if Vince Russo is fired and this occurs, I'm fine with it.
That is a positive.
I don't care.
Absolutely a positive.
I don't care if Eric Bischoff brings... what's his face? David Arquette back to win the fucking TNA world title again. I do not give a fuck what happens in TNA as long as they get rid of Vince Russo. This guy is the epitome of an incompetent, dumb shit wrestling booker. The fucking worst. A show that filled me with sadness and woe. A show put together by a guy that seriously has got no fucking clue. Just no clue. Everything about this show was wrong. Like, everything. So, it opens up with him saying that tonight, Hulk Hogan, and this is a direct quote, quote, Hulk Hogan makes his TNA wrestling debut. A lie. Right there was a lie. Desmond Wolfe comes out, and first off, there's another issue. Desmond Wolfe. What a stupid name. Wolfie McWolferson comes out, and his music is completely generic. It includes a howling wolf. So he does his promo and talks about how he's not the next big thing. He's the only thing. He was raised to be the world's greatest fighter. It was in his genes. Some people were designed to be common folk. He was designed to be a champion. Talks about how Angle didn't really win a gold medal. He won on points, and it was a gift, which actually some people have argued. Talked about how Angle wasn't really a tough guy. It was all a facade. Last week, he laid him out twice on the show. Said in one night, he became the greatest wrestler in the history of TNA. And Angle finally came out. And he cut a promo about how Desmond had overstayed his welcome. He would be leaving the company tonight. Talked about how he put over all the young wrestlers last week, and they had earned his respect, but Desmond had earned nothing. Said Wolfie had messed with the wrong guy, and nobody came into his yard and pissed in it. And the people chanted Angle and this and that, and these two promos were actually going on quite well. Nigel did a good job. Kurt did a good job. So then, of course, Kurt announces that he is challenging Nigel McGuinness to a street fight later. Yes. The first match of the feud is a street fight on Impact, free, with no build.
A week after the debut, yes. Yeah. Besides that, everything was great. Yes, they have, I don't know.
Let me move on.
Yeah, I don't know what to say about this, because I just don't care anymore. They did something stupid. Breaking news. TNA Dome.
AJ and Lauren are watching a replay of the mystery man attacking AJ last week. They're watching this on a TV where we're looking at the back of the TV. They don't show us the TV to see the attack, nor do they show a replay of the attack. So...
they assume...
Why do you watch it on TV? Why are they watching it on TV and we can't see it?
Because, Brian, you no doubt watched it last week, therefore you must remember in crystal clear definition what happened.
Joe walks up and tells AJ that the guy who attacked him was his bald buddy Daniels. I should note, by the way, that Joe in this segment, and also later on in the show, looked significantly trimmer than usual. I'm not sure if he's lost weight, or if he's actually not as fat as he appears in the stupid clothes they make him wear. I would guess the latter. So anyway, he looked trimmer, and he talks about how AJ had been beat up by Daniels, and he said that, or AJ says, there's no way my friend would attack me. And Joe told him he could believe whatever he wanted, but maybe he was just so mad that he could not see his own friend stabbing him in the back. And after Joe walked off, AJ pitched a fit like a little child.
Why? Why was he mad?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. This is a very, very stupid way to build a main event feud. I mean, the whole concept is it's a rematch, and this is their concept, a rematch of the greatest match in company history. Isn't that enough of a story?
No, it's not.
They don't need challenge games. I just like the first part of this when Detective AJ was on the case. He was studying this video, looking for evidence of who attacked him. And Lauren asked if he saw anything. AJ replied, it was dark.
Yeah. Then we have the Alyssa Flash versus Tara match. The announcers are busy talking about Hogan. And then they admit that the show is taped.
Yes. They tell everyone this show was taped before the Hogan announcement was made, so we won't have word from any of the wrestlers. And then the best part was, then they just kept calling the match like it was live.
Yeah. So,
but we'll step back into the time stream now.
They got a lot of time, and the match was completely fine until the stupid finish. Alyssa Flash gives Tara a curb stomp. She puts on her stomach. She grabs her arms like a surfboard. She lifts her up in the air. She puts her foot on the back of her head, and then she stomps her face into the mat. A curb stomp. She hits this vicious move. She goes to lift Tara's dead body up, and Tara proceeds to give her finish for the pin.
That's what happened. Every part of that went down exactly like you described.
Can TNA get some agents with a fucking clue?
I just love that... It was stupid even before the spinning sidewalk slam thing. She hit a curb stomp, posed for a bit, and then went to pick her up. And this goes back to our point. She's already down and laid out. Just pin her.
How? I don't know. I don't know if this match was scripted to go like this. I don't know if these two, Tara and Alyssa Flash, of all people, should know better than to have the finish be a curb stomp followed by the other person hitting their move for the pin.
That is the transition used in my first ever one-on-one wrestling match with myself and Stoney Edwards. In Cloverfield, B.C., I hit an elbow.
Cloverfield?
What was it called?
Cloverdale.
Cloverdale, whatever. I hit a back elbow.
One is a shitty movie. It's a big difference.
One's a shitty town. I say it's closer than you think. Regardless, he called the spot. I hit a back elbow. He took a bump and stood up and hit a power slam and pinned me. That was Stoney Edwards and Shoulders Torelli in a sleeveless t-shirt and volleyball knee pads and tennis shoes in Cloverdale. This was on national television.
Then Kong hit the ring and booted Tara in the chest, gave her an implant buster onto Alyssa, and left them laying. This was the first match on the show, correct?
Yes.
All right, hold on.
You're going to take note? We are one for one in post-match attacks after a match, which I guess is what post-match means.
I'm going to take notes.
Getting a pen.
because I was thinking about this during the show and getting more angry. Alyssa, Tara, Kong. Kong did the run-in.
All right, one for one.
Then we had the Team 3D deal. They were in their locker room having one of those meetings that people don't actually have in real life. They're back there, and Bubba's talking about how these guys fly around a lot, referring to someone who they don't tell us who it is. We later found out it was machine guns. And Devon is just sitting there flexing. Like, boy, look at my biceps. So in walks Rhino. And Rhino says, I'm not here to thank you for saving my life last week. And Bubba says, we didn't save you from Hernandez. We saved Hernandez from Hernandez. Because you see, if Hernandez would have given you a border toss over the top rope to the cement floor and killed you, you would have been suspended, he said. Suspended.
Yes. His exact words were, if your brains had splattered on the floor, Hernandez would have been suspended.
Yeah.
Not fired, nor arrested. Suspended.
So they also told him that if he was thinking about helping them in their match with the guns tonight, well, the guns had never beaten them before, and they weren't going to do so tonight, thereby telegraphing that was exactly what was going to happen. And they said that he was nothing but a conspiracy theorist and called him Lee Harvey. Since when was Lee Harvey Oswald a conspiracy theorist?
Don't know.
Did he theorize there was a conspiracy involved in his death after he died?
Don't know.
Is there a seance somewhere that I am missing?
Don't know.
Hey, bullshit. Bullshit this was.
There was more to come.
Team 3D and the machine guns. This was a match where Bubba Ray nearly killed Chris Sabin. And ironically, it occurred right when Taz was talking about what a bully Bubba Ray was.
Wasn't that amazing?
Bubba Ray picks him up and he gives him a uranage right onto the back of his fucking head. They showed about six or seven replays. After the seventh replay, they cut back and Devon has pressed Chris Sabin's dead body over his head.
Right.
The match is continuing. He drops him.
On his feet.
Shelly
came
ran
in. And kicked Devon and he set Sabin down on his feet. Sabin lands like a yard from his own corner and simply cannot move.
Yeah.
He cannot. He's on his hands and knees. He has no earthly idea what's going on.
No.
He cannot just reach to his right and tag in. They have to. Eventually, he pulls it together after he lifts his arm up, and Shelly tags himself in. And then the match continued.
Sabin laid there.
They had a story to tell, you see.
Sabin laid there in the corner, dead. They thought at the time that he'd broken his neck. This was not enough to stop the match. The show must go on, everybody. So he's laying there dead. They send a trainer out, a number of trainers to take care of him. And meanwhile, in the ring, the match is still going on. So it's Shelly by himself against Team 3D. They do a bunch of moves. And finally, Shelly puts Devon in a half crab, and Devon smashes his hand into the mat. The referee calls for the bell, a submission, a tap out. Devon then says, I didn't tap out. The announcers say it didn't look like a tap out. Then it's over. A complete... This was like...
I just wrote, a complete disaster and a near tragedy.
This was a disaster of a segment in every conceivable way. Let's count the ways.
Someone nearly died.
Okay, first off, some guy nearly got killed. They thought he broke his neck. The match kept going. Devon gets put in a half crab and submits to Alex Shelley, which buries Team 3D.
It's actually even worse than that.
Hold on. So you've buried Team 3D because Devon, out of nowhere, taps to a half crab and his partner just stands on the apron like an idiot. Then they announce it wasn't really a tap. So now the machine guns didn't even win. Then they cut away. Why was this aired? I'll tell you why. Because, well, let's talk about this at the end of the show, but the argument was, why would you air a real injury when you've got a fake injury coming up that you've got to take seriously? And Vince Russo could not understand why you would not put a real injury on TV. Why not? So they left it in.
I don't know.
And that right there killed this entire show. I'll tell you why later on. But just this segment. This segment right here.
One for the absolute ages. One for the history books. Worst segment of wrestling television ever. Everything that went, could go wrong did. Now, I was going to say about the post, everything between the injury and the finish was actually much worse than you described, because Shelley came in, and he was in there with, I guess, D-Von first, and put on a bunch of spinning toe holds. Just put a bunch of spinning toe holds. Team 3D tagged it out for a while, and then Shelley took over and just put on a one-legged crab, and he won.
Yeah.
So the story was Shelley tagged in and completely dominated Team 3D.
Yeah.
By himself. Just shut them down. They were helpless to overcome the submission skills of Alex Shelley.
Because you see, a guy was killed, and they had to improvise the rest of the match and go to the planned finish, which was the machine guns winning.
By stupid non-tap?
Yeah.
They couldn't even do a spot where, like, Team 3D is running wild and bonk into each other, and then Alex Shelley has a half grab?
No.
No.
No. Lauren interviewed Scott Steiner, saying Lashley had demanded he apologize to Krystal. And Steiner said, "I'm sorry. Sorry that she doesn't always like to be with a real man." And he basically said, "Since Lashley cost me my match last week, I'm going to cost him his match this week." And then he says, "I've got a big surprise for Krystal." And he looked down his pants to indicate that the big surprise was his giant cock.
By the way, we did not make note of this, but that tag match ended and there was no post-match attack.
I got it written down here.
Okay, you did. Good.
And this one doesn't count because there was an injury in a finish that came out of nowhere.
It was still a disaster.
Obviously, Sabin cannot be attacked post-match. Hermie Sadler...
This...
Oh, God.
I take back what I said about Team 3D versus the Machine Guns.
This was the new worst segment.
This was the worst thing I ever saw.
Hermie Sadler, and that right there, someone explain to me why, on a national television show, I live in Seattle, Washington, everybody, okay? There are people that watch this show in New York City. There are people that watch this show in San Jose, California, Los Angeles.
Well, one guy.
Medford, Oregon, Portland. This, in fact, more than that, this show goes internationally. It goes to markets all over the world. Explain to me why Hermie Sadler is an interview person for your company. The only reason that Hermie Sadler is on this show is because this is a Nashville-based company, and he's a NASCAR geek or something. Okay? It's not like this is some sort of low-level local celebrity that's actually talented in the sense that he's a great guy to interview people. For example, Bob Barker. You know what I mean? If Raw could get Bob Barker every week to interview folks for their TV show, that'd be one thing. They got Hermie Sadler, who is a black hole of charisma. He's on this worldwide television show, and he interviews Red and Don West. Red admits to the world he can't cut a promo.
Yeah, well, okay.
That's why he has Don.
It's Hermie, Red, and Don. The Don and Red are sitting on the couch. Red looks maybe 7 years old. This looks like crazy Uncle Don and his touched-in-the-head nephew, Red. And so Hermie asks a question, and Red speaks first. And yes, as you noted, Red's answer to the question was basically, "I cannot cut a good promo, and so I went out and got Don."
Yeah.
So then Hermie asks a question of Don West. And the question was, and I am not making this up, "What do you see in this guy?" What do you see in this guy?
Yeah.
And so Don started to be Don West and talk about how Red is everything a wrestler should be, everything parents look for in a role model. And as he's speaking, and I'm not making this up either, they cut him off mid-sentence.
Yeah. Yes.
They cut off Don West mid-sentence as he was selling Red. Then we never saw any of these people again. Well, I take that back. We saw Don West later. But
now let me add also that all of the work that we just put into explaining this, the actual segment did not exceed 20 seconds.
No way. No way. This was... I am still shell-shocked by the horror of the segment. This was so bad.
Let me ask a question again. Why fucking bother?
There are a bunch of times in the show, because, you see, they filmed a two-hour show, then had to cut out stuff to make room for Hulk Hogan. They left in the match where a guy nearly died.
Oh, yeah. And this.
And this.
Then we had, for no conceivable reason whatsoever, Eric Young versus Bobby Lashley for the Legends title. Maybe the match Lashley won whenever he won his last match was a number one contender's title. I don't know. So Steiner, as promised, attacked him at ringside, right in front of the ref, clotheslines him on the floor. The ref don't care. That's fine, okay? We'll just presume it's a no DQ match. So Lashley gets in the ring. He puts Eric in the Dragon Sleeper. Steiner gets in the ring, hits him with a chair. This is a DQ. Why not?
I just like that they couldn't let Eric Young lose.
Well, he can. He's the champion.
He couldn't book a non-title match. Okay, fine. If Eric Young can't lose, why did they book this match?
I don't know. Because we had to have a run-in. Anyway, so Steiner had Krystal and her titties airbrushed on his shirt, and he put Lashley in the recliner afterwards. So we can now add Steiner, Eric, with...
Lashley, Eric, with Steiner.
Oh, yeah. I was all confused.
Regardless.
How did Steiner run in his own match?
They have not yet found a way to do that.
Well, they will at some point, I'm sure.
I'm not putting it past them.
Rick Steiner did once when he was the mystery man. So then we add the British Invasion in the ring in matching tracksuits.
This is by far the best part of the show. World Elite, they all went out and got matching tracksuits or jumpsuits. They were, like, white. And they were all in the ring together. They were all wearing them, except Eric Young, who had just wrestled a match, and Homicide, who apparently just said, fuck no, I'm not wearing that.
So, Magnus says, the rumors are true. The invasion has been suspended without pay until Turning Point.
Did you hear a rumor?
I had not.
I didn't hear a rumor.
He explains
that... Did it start a rumor?
TNA officials were upset at them for punching the ref last week in the cage match for the DQ. Remember that? The cage match that went to a DQ?
Yes.
Yeah. They've been suspended without pay. They proceed to mock the suspension and the fine, which has been levied upon them. And why not? Because they've been suspended, and here they are on TV in a major segment cutting a promo. Hell of a suspension, TNA.
He outright said it was a loophole.
Yes. He says it's not a suspension, it's merely a vacation. We're just going to have fun as we sit here in the ring and tell you about this. So then Eric Young said, I am now going to make my announcement that is going to rock the wrestling world to its foundations.
And I was hoping with all my heart that his announcement would be that they now had matching tracksuits. That would have been great.
It would have been better. The announcement that is going to rock the wrestling world to its foundations is that the Legends title is dead. He said it is now his title, his championship, his belt, and we could refer to it as the TNA Global Championship. He said there were two rules. Number one, he would never defend the belt on American soil. And number two, he would never defend the belt against an American. Which begs the question, who will he defend against if...
If all the foreigners are on his own team?
If he is in charge of World Elite.
Yes. Well,
so,
I don't know.
I just like that TNA management suspends the British Invasion for causing a DQ in a cage match, which, by the way, they allowed, apparently. But they suspend them for that, but they're completely fine with Eric Young putting an embargo on their own championship.
Don't know.
No,
I don't know. Maybe they realize this is just the fake belt Booker brought in.
Because they announced on TV that it was now an official company title.
Yeah.
And now he's changing the name and making his own rules, and that's fine. So, anyway, Nash comes out, moving as slowly as a glacier. And he says he wants his $60,000 in his belt back. And Eric said, listen, this should be water under the bridge. And as they're talking, suddenly beer money is in the ring and they're hitting everybody with chairs and stop signs. I'd have no fucking idea why, but that's what happened. And this was a clusterfuck.
I do like when Nash said that the Sheik had paid him $60,000 in, and again, I quote, Iranian dollars.
Yes.
Dollars.
Dollars. Yeah. Iranian dollars.
Iranian dollars.
Vince, you pay slightly more attention to me based on history. Why did beer money run in and attack the British invasion and, or I'm sorry, the entire World Elite with stop signs and chairs?
I guess because they were angry about losing the cage match last week.
There was that, wasn't there?
There's the title match.
I'd forgotten who was in the cage match. All right. Daniels met with AJ, wanted to make sure that AJ did not believe the story that Joe had told.
Yes.
A horribly acted
this
segment.
This is so bad.
And actually, this should tell you what a bad actor AJ is, because Chris Daniels is a trained actor.
Yeah.
And he was fine on the rest of the show. But with AJ, they got into a huge, catty, poorly acted argument, and Daniels finally said, I'm going to go settle this with Joe.
See, I will disagree with one of your points, because I thought the segment with Joe was just as bad.
No, I thought the one with Joe was 100 times better.
But, yes, Daniels met with AJ, and AJ says, don't worry about it. And somehow, this angered Daniels. This doesn't make sense.
That's later. You're getting ahead of yourself.
Well, no, because he said, what do you mean you don't think it was me? Or something. And yes, the world champion and his top contender, they bickered like 12-year-old girls. And it made me want to never see them again.
Beautiful people came out and skipped to the ring.
They skipped to the ring. They put up a graphic and it said, beautiful people spent $35,000 on a shopping spree in L.A. during BFG weekend. That's a funny thing to put on the graphic as these girls make their entrance. And that's a cool idea. The problem is, I read very quickly. And I could barely get this in the time it came up on the screen and then disappeared, so they could cut away and show us a replay of that stupid food fight.
We had the beautiful people, and by the way, that includes Lacey Von Erich, against Christy, Hamada, and ODB. A battle this was. Hamada was a one-eyed woman in the land of the blind. Actually, a two-eyed woman in this land of the blind.
She's even psychic in the land of the blind.
So anyway, this was a horribly wrestled, a horribly filmed battle. Lacey was in there very momentarily with Hamada, which actually, I'm not going to say what I was thinking, but I got extremely excited. And unfortunately, she tagged out immediately, made me very sad.
I will say that for the entire, literally, the entire segment they were in there, the cameraman shot this from behind Lacey and Velvet, so we just saw their asses.
Yeah.
And I endorse this. I'd rather see that than watch Lacey wrestle Hamada.
Oh, no. I badly wanted to see Lacey wrestle Hamada. Badly. So Hamada finally gets the hot hand, ODB. ODB runs wild. Of course, nobody's feeding her, so she's running around like a chicken with her head cut off. Bodies are everywhere. It is a complete disaster. And finally, at the finish, think about this. It's a six-person tag with Christy, Hamada, ODB, the beautiful people. Think about all of the wrestlers you've ever seen in your entire life. Of all the wrestlers on the planet Earth, of all the living wrestlers on the Earth today, the two wrestlers they put into this ring for the finish of this match were Christy Hemme and Lacey Von Erich. Again, I ask, can TNA get some fucking agents with a clue? Lacey gets in there. I don't even know how to explain this. She did a choke slam.
I will tell you, the short version is she hit a choke slam. Hitting this choke slam,
she may as well have been building an airplane.
Yeah, it was like a 14-step process. It was like a Rube Goldberg cartoon where you must, you know, mouse runs down track A, which spins the wheel B, which rotates the crank, etc., etc. She put her hand on Christy's neck, then she grabbed Christy's arm and threw it high in the air, then on her own shoulder, then she waved her hand out and then placed it somewhere on Christy, and then she crouched to lift. It was just like, it was amazing.
Christy Hemme and Lacey Von Erich. Can you believe that this is the finish of your match?
Yes.
They put these two in the fucking ring together for the finish of the match. I don't know.
So they did this choke slam. Lacey got the pin. They cut to ODB on the ramp, who apparently had been watching, and she just looked like she smelled the most foul thing on Earth.
And what happens after the match? Kong runs in.
Kong runs in.
Kong ran in and beat everyone. Actually, no, I'm sorry. Kong ran in to beat everyone up, and Tara ran down to break it up, and we had six grown men attempting to tear these women apart, and they all failed. This was some bullshit. Then we had Dr. Stevie come out, and he said that if Abyss wanted to be a monster, he could come out tonight and see the monster he had created in Stevie. And they noted that Daphne was supposed to be in this match, but she was in no condition to perform, because, of course, she broke her arm at the pay-per-view. Yes.
So, yeah, they mentioned that this is a no-DQ match because there was no better way to settle this rivalry. Was it Monster's Ball to settle this rivalry?
It gets better. They have a match. It's a hardcore match. So, of course, Stevie gets the heat by applying leg holds.
Yes.
Brilliant idea there.
This happened.
So then Abyss, out of nowhere, hits a torture rock drop for the, torture rack drop for the pin.
I like and torture then... rock drop.
Stevie attacks him with a kendo stick. So there's another one.
And yes, and Mike Tenay said these words. And for like the fifth time in the show, I'm not making this quote up. Who cares about the match when you win the post-match battle?
Yeah.
The after-match attack is, in the words of TNA's own announcers, more important than the match itself.
Yes. So Stevie attacks him with the kendo stick, and, of course, his feud must continue. And as he's attacking him
it
with
was
this...
not settled by the no DQ match.
As is...
God damn it! So, I don't know. This is like trying to watch... This is like putting a blind man in a car in an empty parking lot and watching him trying to drive out. It's amazing.
So he's attacking him with the fucking kendo stick, and out comes Mick Foley. Mick Foley proceeds to get in the ring, and, of course, as a swerve, he attacks Stevie. Because, you see, this is leading to Mick Foley and Abyss becoming a tag team. Why not?
All I know is this is here. This is here is where I wrote down Hulk Hogan cannot get here soon enough. He must walk in and say, I hate Vince Russo, I want him gone. And he has to be out the door. And whatever Hulk Hogan produces, it will be a better television show than this.
Borash interviews Foley about why he saved Abyss. No comment. We had Matt Morgan and Rhino. Match was all right. And Morgan wins with the carbon footprint. And so Rhino beats him up afterwards.
Right.
Oh, yeah, that's
because
the
post-match attack is more important than the match. So he was beating him up. He hit a gore. To say Matt Morgan took a horrible bump for this gore would be such the understatement. This looked like he was not only not taking a bump or selling the gore, this looked like he was trying to stay on his feet.
Yeah.
It looked like he planted his feet and leaned his weight into Rhino, trying to separate his shoulder. And Rhino did come up selling his shoulder. So this sucked. And then Hernandez came out to do a run-in to save a guy from the other run-in.
Mm-hmm.
Or something.
Of course. Daniels met with Joe backstage, told him to knock the games off. Joe said, you know what, when I talked to AJ... and said you may have attacked him, he rolled his eyes, meaning your best friend doesn't think you're in his league. He told him to think about it. Then he walked off, and Chris Daniels got really mad and hit a picture of Joe. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I thought Daniels was still no good here. I thought Joe was okay, but whatever. There are other things to talk about in the show.
Hold on a second. How could you say Daniels was no good when his entire role was to stand there and look at Joe as Joe spoke?
I just remember his the opening when he like called Joe down the hallway and then he called Joe's name and Joe turned around and Daniels approached him and then he had a short monologue. Mm. And that short monologue, I thought to myself, I don't believe you.
Homicide cornered Don West and demanded a title match at Bound for Glory. He then proceeded to rob him. He took out his wallet. He took money out of his wallet on national television. And then he took his driver's license and said he was going to hold it until the pay-per-view.
I don't know.
His driver's license.
Maybe he was looking for his library card and couldn't find it. But yes, Don West was doing the house show plug when Homicide ran in to intimidate him into getting a title shot.
He's going to hold his driver's license.
And
is he renting bowling shoes?
I don't know.
What do you have to leave your license with someone for?
To buy, well, now you can't prove he's 21 and can't buy liquor.
Everybody, Homicide took his driver's license and said he's holding on to it until the pay-per-view. Why?
You know, I know we've all done it. I know going to the DMV is no fun, but you can get a replacement license. It's not that hard. I cannot hate this because of Don West's performance. He was so terrified.
JB interviews Angle, who's a babyface, who, by the way, is still wearing all of his Main Event Mafia stuff.
I forgot to mention this during the intro, but yes, he has his music back, and he's a total babyface, but he still has pinstripes and roses on his gear in his video.
So she's interviewing him, and I don't even know what he said, because the next thing you know...
I'm so happy. My notes read, I wasn't paying attention. Something about somebody in power trying to get rid of him.
But the next thing you know, AJ is down backstage and bleeding out of the back of his head. And Lauren asks, is he okay? And they immediately cut away. Because it's only their world champion who's apparently dead. More important things to do.
Gotta pay the bills.
They got a commercial. They come back. And an ambulance is zooming off. And Lauren is saying that he is being taken to the hospital after being beaten up for the second time in a row. So I guess they were referring to last week. It would have been nice to tell us and clear that up. And by the way, yes, I'll just talk about this when I talk about the main event. Angle and Nigel McWolferson, they have a match, and it is, of course, Desmond's first TNA match for free on Impact in a street fight. And the best part is the street fight never leaves the ring.
Yeah. Well, they did brawl on the floor.
So they have this match. Angle beats him all over the place. Nigel tries the loop-de-loo lariat. Angle ducks, hits the rolling Germans, and he hits the last German. Nigel pops up. There's an edit, and then he clotheslines him, and Angle takes this big bump. Earl Hebner then drops down and basically says the match can't continue. He's hurt. They proceed to stretcher out Angle. Let's think about this for a while. When you read the spoilers and you read about the debut of Nigel McGuinness did not go to WWE, everybody. He went to TNA. You read about that in the spoilers and you're like, wow, this is some big news. A guy he's gone to TNA, the former ROH champion, not going to WWE. He debuts in TNA. Not only that, he's going to be feuding with Kurt Angle. He gets pushed right to the top. He attacks him on week one. And then week two, he lays him out with a lariat, and Angle is stretchered out. This is like, when you read this, you're like, this is fucking big. This is going to be really cool. Then you watch the show. If you've got an Angle where a guy debuts in the ring and he lays out Kurt Angle with a clothesline and Kurt Angle is stretchered out of the building and taken to the hospital, that's a big thing. So why in the previous segment, the segment that immediately precedes this, you do an angle where AJ Styles is laid out and taken off in an ambulance? That right there is just like, you should be fired from TNA. You should be banished from the professional wrestling business. You should never, ever be allowed to book another pro wrestling show as long as you live. That is the absolute utmost in goddamn stupidity right there. To do an ambulance angle right before you're going to do a stretcher angle that's supposed to make an impact. I mean, this is just like all the years Vince Russo has been in this business. All these years, and he still doesn't have clue one. It gets better. You have a guy earlier in the show that gets hurt. Gets hurt legit. Dropped right on his head. They think he might have broken his neck. He can't move. People go up to him and say, hey, you know, we probably shouldn't put this on the show if you won this main event angle with Angle and Nigel to have any impact. Oh, no, 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 no. Why the fuck would you not air a real injury on TV? The guy really got hurt. We got to put this on TV. So we get earlier in the show, a fucking guy get dropped right on his neck, seemingly paralyzed, seemingly broken neck. The match continues. When Kurt Angle takes a clothesline in the main event, they stop the fucking match. I mean, this is just like, how? This moment was when I thought, Hulk Hogan, please, bring in fucking Kevin Sullivan. Bring in fucking Ed Leslie. Bring in the fucking Nasty Boys. Yep, yep. Bring in all of
Jimmy
your
Hart.
Goofball friends. Jimmy, oh,
Nasty
love,
Nick.
I like Jimmy Hart. Bring in Nick Hogan. Bring in Brooke. Bring in, I was going to say The Wall, but he's passed on. Bring in every goofball that you know, every geek that you hang around with. Bring in fucking Bubba the Love Sponge. Make him the world champion. I do not give a fuck. I don't give a fuck what you do. Vince Russo's got to go. I mean, this show right here is just... And we wrote about it. We wrote about how everybody backstage realized that these people had no idea what they were fucking doing. And at the time, I was like, they've not known what they were doing for a long time now, you know? What's different this week? Then I watched this show. Holy creeping Christ. This is the worst.
This was very, very bad. And top it all off, by the way, during the Kurt Angle versus Desmond Wolfe match, Mike's name made an announcement. Chris Sabin's going to be fine.
Yeah.
the guy with the real injury, he's going to be okay. So I guess there's nothing to worry about here in these other two fake injuries.
Oh, my God. This is just this is like a parody of Vince Russo booking. That's how bad this was. This is like if somebody said, I'm going to do a Saturday Night Live skit on Vince Russo booking a wrestling show, and they came up with this.
Well, to be fair, there was nothing on a pole in the show. All those missing.
I'd have preferred a pole. I would have preferred two pole matches to stretching out AJ Styles and putting him in an ambulance and the real-life injury that detracted from the main event that you just had to air on TV.
They should have had a shot of the stretcher crew carrying Kurt into the parking lot and saying, oh, shit, the ambulance is gone.
Like last week when they put Rhino in the ambulance and was it Rhino?
It was a couple weeks ago. He had
they put him in the ambulance and Lashley standing there with his ribs busted.
Exactly, yes.
They just left him there. So then the show ended with clips from the press conference, and I was never so happy to see Hulk Hogan. I was just begging for this guy to just walk in and just leave bodies in his wake. Just a rampage of fire everybody and bring in all your friends. I so don't care at this point.
No.
I don't care.
The press conference was pretty much nothing, and Dixie said he's famous. We're happy to have him.
Give Kevin Nash the book.
Why
That's
not?
How little I care.
Why not?
Give Kevin Nash and Kevin Sullivan the book. Let them write this show. I guarantee it will be better. I guarantee it.
So then Hogan is talking, and he goes into his what you gonna do speech when he never said the words TNA. It was Hogan and Spike TV and Dixie Carter.
I think
Carter.
He mentioned TNA a couple times. I was counting.
On that line, he didn't. But and he started to say, when we all run wild on you. And then again, for the 47th time in the show, they cut him off.
Mm-hmm.
They cut off Hulk Hogan mid-sentence. Their biggest signing ever. They cut him off mid-sentence. The other note of this press conference was they plugged Dixie Carter's Twitter page.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, there's two. I've loaded it. There are two tweets on this page. Let's see. About 11 hours ago, celebrated the Hogan signing at staff meeting this morning with champagne and donuts. A new beginning for TNA. Then, about 6 hours ago. Okay. Many of you have told me to remind people to watch Impact tonight. By the way, she spelled U with the letter U, but still took time to write Impact as lowercase I and the rest all in capitals with an exclamation point. I am pouring a glass of wine and getting ready to single O myself. Big night! And it was. It was a big night.
Oh, my God. And by the way, for those keeping track, we had 7 matches on this show. 5 of them involved a post-match attack or run-in, and the only two that did not were the real injury and the fake injury.
The fake injury that led to a referee stoppage in a street fight.
That never left the ring.
So he gets a thumbs down. I piss on this show.
The barbed wire Christmas tree set new standards.
There have been shows that I was in a much fouler mood. Maybe it's just because I don't know. The show sucked.
This show sucked a penis.